Hey guys, so if you're new here, or if you're not, if you want to hear me voice act, head over to our main channel, links down below. And if you don't, this channel's solely for TTS. If you want to know all the details about what's going on, we have a stream up that you can go and watch, but let's just get into the video.
So I'm a Necron Cryptek, so what? Part number 8. Orokin secluded himself in his ship to begin his divinations. I had already provided Orokin with several ancient maps from the original Battlefleet Gothic game. Six subsectors where they had been at one point before Abaddon had captured them. It was no guarantee that they would be in the same place. But all of these had been found in this region of space. If I came back with all six of these Blackstone fortresses, I would cream myself. Trazin and Phileas sent swarms of small scouting vessels out. If Orokin did not find everything, we would cast a wide enough net to guarantee we would find a fortress or two. I sat back and watched dozens of ships disembarking into the void. I sent out orders to look for any signs of power sources or anomalous occurrences to the fleet. We had an immense 7 million cubic light years worth of space to explore, if not more. I don't expect them to find anything right away. Orokin was probably going to spend a few years getting himself in his little time bubble. Doing so to let himself do longer in-depth divinations. That was well enough for me. We might be here for a few centuries. 20 years passed with no incident. I had spent that time helping in the effort. What we had found surprisingly was massive mile-wide clusters of mineral asteroids. Since I didn't have much else to do, I had my scorpoids begin harvesting the materials. It would be nice to try my hand with some new foreign substances. We mined one asteroid for 37 years straight before it ran out of any materials of note. Still no reports on the first fortress. Still no word from Orokin. I had gotten started on working on another wafer of amerithine. But by halfway through the intensive process, I was pinged by Orokin. He had claimed he had found one anomalous power source in one section of space. Nearly 79 years in meditation and he finally gets a beat on one. I could insult him later. In any case, Orokin, Phileas, Trazin and myself made way towards this power source he had detected. We ended up passing through the nebula to get where we needed to go. We were making way towards a subsystem finally. There was a formation of 10 stars that had matched what we had been looking for. A great big constellation as was depicted in the old books. Orokin was able to narrow it down to a section where 3 stars were, and immediately I pointed to one star. There, Brigia, right there. I tapped the glyph screen and sent him and the rest of our team to look at the area. We'll find it somewhere near there. Orokin sighed and took my word for it. Over the next few weeks we closed in. I was so filled with anticipation I could hardly wait. Finally we entered into the solar system. We saw a few gas giants, asteroid belts, a few frozen planetoids orbiting an old star. It was so cluttered with debris, so many frozen clusters, and floating yet to be identified masses. Somewhere in this system we would find that planetoid. Fanning out we split up into sections. I was looking through the habitable zone. 3 planets were here. One day long from now these worlds would support billions of human lives. It was a nice distracting thought, but I needed to focus. I looked over the first planet's orbiting satellites and found them each to be far too oblong to match the shape of a fortress. The second planet had none to speak of, but it looked as though the planet was ripe for populating. It was free of pollution, a virgin world. I shrugged off the thoughts and pressed onto the final world. It was littered in orbiting clusters. It was half the size of the planet Neptune. So much water, great stretches of land masses, it was beautiful. I watched it absent-mindedly for a few hours. I felt like an astronaut for a bit. I had been traveling across millions of light years, and never really stopped to consider it. It was so mundane to a Necron, but not for a human. All that line of thinking was cut off as I saw the Blackstone peeking out from behind the enormous planet's shadow. I called over everyone, informing them we had found it. The derelict ship was awaiting us. I had us brought in closer, and as we approached we were greeted by unsettling sights. Clusters upon clusters of space hulks of Edery, Orcoid, and other Xenorex floated in orbit of the fortress. Still we pushed on. closer to the moon-sized star fortress. We reached one of its underbelly gates. And I simply remained at the bridge too awestruck to even speak. I touched the display glyph, as if touching it was me touching the great fortress. So long have I waited for this. The four other ships closed. We once more hopped onto a call. Trazin was the first to pipe up. This place, it's a treasure trove of relics. Derelict ships of at least 20 different races I've managed to identify, these are all impossibly ancient. They're all forming around the Blackstone, not on it. That was curious. I piped up. We need to send a scouting force ahead. See if the defenses of the Blackstone are active, the power should be on from what I know. I informed them of fluctuations in gravity, and the uncertain nature of the rooms caused by the Blackstone Fortress's defenses. We deployed a small force, hundreds of scarabs, wraiths, scorpoids and squads of deathmarks. The most mobile individuals who could navigate unhindered by most of the defenses. Along with the deathmarks I had trained to spot spindle drone eyes, I think we had a good chance. They left with a handful of relay nodes, something to keep communications up in the event we lost comms to them. We all watched as they headed into one opening in the fortress, a triangular passage in. Entering in, they kept a continued stream of updates. Everything was alright. We were receiving a grainy live stream of their entrance. We couldn't clear it up with all this Hulk debris interfering. They traveled a few miles before they finally reached a torn down gateway. They waded through the rubble to enter into the chamber. A few scorpoids dedicated themselves to harvesting the debris of the doorway for future clearance. Traveling, they found a small chamber bearing a spire and a few lights to brighten the room. The tiled floor was a hexagonal grid, seemingly randomly dipping across the floor. A few connected doorways led to a few other chambers. They opened up another chamber, and immediately opened fire. They had peppered a spindle drone full of beams of gauze shots, energy beams, and dissipation beams. It cracked and fell under such a concentrated beam of deadly shots. But as they focused in, they found the drones were inactive. Half a dozen dead drones were strewn about the tight hall. They had either been killed or without power for who knows how long. One Deathmark collected the bodies, and sent them back on towards the entrance. We would have time to research these drones while they ventured deep. Trezzy, Orokin and I were all pleased with this development. No doubt we would be bickering who gets to dissect the thing. They marched onwards into the Blackstone. Scarabs mapping out every inch of the structures. Nodes were placed all over the walls. The narrows seemed to expand outwards, lacking any proper organization. Eventually the floor began to incline until it reached the point where it became a sheer wall they had to climb. This presented no issues to the floating masses, they simply began moving upwards. The Deathmarks held onto the wraiths and ascended towards an opening. Once they reached the top they found themselves in a secure antechamber. They spread out across the chamber, they saw one diverging room quite well lit. Heading to the light they looked out to the expanse before them. It was a massive drop down. The lighting we had seen had been coming off randomly off surfaces with little reason. Looking at its complex and seemingly impossible geometry gave me a slight headache. They did notice some movements however, nothing clear. A quick blur in the far distance moving from one chamber to the next. This fortress was inhabited by something. Gravity was actually a fluid thing here. The rules of this chamber seemed to be that any surface had its own gravity. Should something float, they would simply fall weightlessly in the center of the room. We had a few scarabs that had got caught in this strange phenomena. They caught glimpses of ancient calcified husks of debris occasionally floating lazily. I could have sworn I saw a floating calcified orc skull. The group moved towards the movement they had seen from afar. All of their weapons were primed to fire. They continued to wade through the strange chamber for an hour before they reached the opening. They occasionally collected samples of the remains of what remained. One such peculiarity was a red crystalline humanoid mass. It had branches and roots growing from parts of its body but it still had humanism features. The quality was too bad to discern much of it, we had it sent back through the pipeline. They pressed on, entering in that next hall. Gravity had taken normal route the instant they stepped onto the floor of this chamber. One Canoptic Acanthrite noticed something as they entered this chamber. Organic matter, clumps of hair. Samples were collected naturally, but it informed at least some sort of mammalian creature was inside the black stone. Or at the very least something wearing a poor quality pelt. They pressed onwards for a few hours, finding more signs of this place being inhabited. Strange holes littering the black stone walls, flakes of skin tissue, nondescript puddles, dried up plant fibers. I would have continued to watch, but I finally received the spindle drone remains. Each of us received two. Mine were more intact. Orokin and Trazin received less than mint condition drones. I went quiet upon realizing something. Spindle drones aren't normally able to leave the Blackstone. When defeated, they are absorbed by the Blackstone. So why didn't it do that? Could it be that it's because it recognizes the ship as being also made of Blackstone? That would explain why it's allowed to leave the fortress. But that still leaves the question why it hasn't been absorbed by the Blackstone. I have the two sets of drones locked into floating suspension fields. Much of this gave me cause for concern. I would have continued to study, but I received several pings that called for my attention. Rushing to the bridge, I came to look upon the screen. They had reached a chamber bearing a maglev lift. What's more, there appeared to be seemingly intricate alien technology littering the room. There appeared to be more of the crystalline tree people here. I wasn't sure what they could be. I gave the order to collect them, and then ordered them to delve deeper on the maglev. They did so without question. One Deathmark sunk his hand into a slot terminal on the maglev. He shook for a moment before the maglev stirred. Quickly the chamber opened up. Walls flying away like theater curtains, and extensive railway for which the maglev could travel upon. The maglev rocketed off. Feverishly the Deathmarks planted the relay nodes into surfaces hastily. The connection stuttered and the quality noticeably dipped. God, it was like looking a 144p video. I gave the order to the Scorpoids to rush back and bore tunnels into the maglev railway chamber. We can't lose connection with them. The fucking latency of the transmission was awful. The main scouting team continued to travel with the Scorpoids working feverishly behind them. Eventually, after a few minutes, the maglev stopped at a hard to describe scene. As in, there was so much indescribable debris that littered the chamber, still they gave static-filled responses. They mostly spoke of machinery, things like flying craft, or ramshackle-looking weaponry. But for the briefest moments I saw something through all of the film grain, pixelation, and latency. Is that? That's a bloody crawk. I exclaimed. The others took keen interest. The Deathmarks informed me it was ancient and massively damaged, back broken, major breaches in the armor and small beam holes. Move onwards, find out whatever is alive down there, I ordered. They nodded along and kept moving through. Phileas pinged me on a private line. Cryptek, what is it exactly you believe we may find down here? I shrugged. The Blackstone has a way of attracting many to it, whether they know it or not. Us, however, it should be anathema to us. As far as I know, no Necron has ever wielded one. It is my belief that these great bulwarks were once a creation of the old ones. Phileas and I spoke for many days after that, occasionally noting all manner of small finds. Quality fluctuated often. More anomalous things came to pass. They were met with more spindle drones as they progressed, most offline, disked, or in some rare cases no clipped into walls at odd angles. There were more signs constantly showing signs of life living here. Markings on walls and dried up flaking fluids, more plant fibers, symbols of dozens of unknown races littered the walls or piles of metal debris. I could understand none of it. They did report on one piece of debris having an amphibious face. One time after seeing more signs of Krog activity, I swore out this is the Precipice Fortress all over again. I hadn't realized I had still been on the private call with Phileas, and she seemed to want me to dive a bit more onto that topic. I shut up right away. I waited a few minutes hoping for some unexpected developments to let me worm my way out of the conversation. After 47 minutes Phileas hissed an order to me. Ishka, this continued silence is wearing on my patience. Do you believe I will let you keep secrets from me anymore? She ran her fingers over the crackling orbit of her relic war scythe. I immediately blurted. Phileas, I do not perform well under constant threat of vile. I slapped my hands over my mouth. I fucked up. I immediately began spam-pinging Orican. Phileas had left the call. I was fucking trembling. Phileas will not take me yelling at her laying down. Orican answered and I received an override order on the bridge of the ship. Orican, you damnable bitch, jump back in the timeline 2 minuets ago and call me. I screeched at him. He was about to argue, but then he noted something crackling to life. Phileas had hard translated onto the bridge of my ship, warside held aloft. Orican fucking do it. I yelled as Phileas gutted me, hoisting me up through my ribcage. Her warside tore at my insides as she brought me closer to her. I can tolerate much from you, Cryptek, but your continued actions are making me reconsider. I let out another sigh and groan. The fucking image quality was horrendous. The death marks held up a calcified orcoid. Maybe Krork? I was about to burst into a hail of obscenities. But I received a ping from Orican. Ack, one moment, executioner Phileas. I need to speak with Orican. I joined a call with Orican. Without warning he started, I would be careful with the executioner. Your over familiarity with her will lead to problems, Cryptek. What? Before I could ask him what that meant he left the call. I shrug it off as more divinatory bullshit. For now I go back to watching the Deathmarks feed for a few hours. And boy was I glad I did. They entered a massive chamber with a steep fall down and a doorway located a few miles upwards. They would have to get up there, or they would have had they not noticed something deep in the depths of the pit. A ship that was unmistakable of Xeno make. It was hovering in place, with messes of cables drilled into the Blackstone. They had even managed to have several pathways carved into the lower levels of the Blackstone. Everything fucking snapped into focus. The plant fibers, the liquid pools, the beam holes, the paints on the wall. This was all the work of the Jacaro. I turned to my bridge crew. I need a crew. I need to go inside there. Within the army, a massive vanguard of warriors and the whole Godslam command structure of Necrons would be traveling in a shuttle to the fortress. I needed to personally deal with the monkeys myself. The group didn't seem to think so but wouldn't let me go without them. I was beyond excited to try to meet the Jacaro. No doubt they would try and kill us, but damn, was this worth a shot. If not, Trazin would capture all of them in a Tesseract labyrinth. We headed in the Blackstone Fortress with no issue. Once we cleared the recently cleared doorway, Trazin and Orican began running all over the place with rapt attention. I hurried them along. Keep up, we have greater discoveries to see. I was more giddy to see the monkeys. We made way for the strange gravity-defying chamber. I found my gun platforms were more or less immune to the movement. The propulsion network was far stronger than that one of our other constructs. I had one commandeered for myself, Nehebkor, Orican, Phileas, and Trazin. We were able to arrive at the next chamber several hours ahead of our fighting force. Immediately all but Phileas began to scour the room for relics. There were scorpoids excavating the various items from the room. I finally got a chance to look at the crystalline tree things. To my horror, I instantly recognized what it was now that I wasn't looking at a 240p visual transmission. It was an Ildiri Farseer, casting a spell. It was entirely made of what I can assume was a psychically resonant crystal-like soul stones. Its legs and arms sported branches of a tree-like crystalline tendrils. I scanned the Ildiri up and down. No signs of life. The thing was solid crystal all the way through. It must have been at least older than 40,000 years old minimum. Eldred was turning to crystal at the ripe age of maybe 30,000 years of life. But this was crystal all the way through. Though it may also be that a Soledary was conducting research, I mumbled. I turned to Trazin. We're going to find more of these. I want to split half of these with you. Trazin turned to me, Deathmask and that smug perma grin. He gave a nod. But of course, dear Awakener, I would be more than willing to share in your plight for knowledge. I will, however, receive pickings. I let out a soft laugh and sigh. I had a feeling you'd say that. Returning my attention to the statue, I was reminded of another crystalline occurrence. Remembering that aboard the Vengeful Spirit, there existed a psychic crystalline formation of Sanguinius existed perpetually. I would have continued thinking about that, when I felt a change in temperature. My first thought was to turn to Orokin, but I found that the heat was entirely centralized to one single string on my harp. The empiric chord. I lifted my harp. There was a tiny noticeable collection of purple little particles streaming from the eldery to the chord. It was strange. Taking a peek over my Oculus, I tried scanning the phenomenon. 300 scans over the course of 2 minutes of staring up next to nothing. The only thing that was being picked up was a thermal scan. I tried shutting off my ocular to blink for a moment to muse on it. But what do I still see in that darkness of my closed eye? The purple fucking particles floating off of the crystal and towards for my string. What the hell is this warp shit? I mumbled to myself. Phileas leaned uncomfortably close after that hushed curse, asking, "Pardon? Forgive me, I just noticed all this." I pointed to the weird warp particle tether. She stared for a few minutes, and so did I. "What are you expecting me to see here?" she asked. "Wait, can you not see it?" I would have raised an eyebrow. She gave an odd no. "It's all these little purple party." It soon dawned on me for a moment. Necrons can't see warp occurrences. They can see the physical manifestations but not phenomena like this. So why could I see it? I dialed back my chronozine. I can't continue that sentence. "Pardon, I don't mean to bother you with cryptic babble. I mean to say that this crystalline form is radiating some thermal energy." That was enough to placate her. This was another thing on the list of things to investigate. Man, I had a steadily growing list of anomalies to look into. After Trazin pocketed the contents of the room into a tesseract labyrinth, we waited on entourage and marched on. We arrived at the maglev room and found the collection of alien tech. None of it was recognized by me or Trazin. Hopping onto the maglev, I took center stage and jammed my hand into the slip and activated the maglev. It sputtered for a moment before propelling us forward. For several moments we were on the fast track up ahead. But something changed. There was more fog around. We could hear a loud pressurized hissing, as though some safe doors were opening, pounding down with a heavy thud, and crushing several immortals. Came a set of two Guardians drone, and a trio of spindle drones. Their bodies twitched, like unhinged puppets, nothing like I had read about. They moved more like the Guardian scouts from Bot. No time to think about that. "Fire on that thing now," I shouted. After those words left my lipless mouth, I felt a searing, overwhelming pain, and a heat like no other. There was a hole burned into my chest cavity, and I keeled over dying. All manner of bolts of plasma firing around me as I faded. We arrived at the maglev room and found the collection of alien tech. None of it was recognized by me or Trazin. Hopping onto the maglev, I took center stage. Orokin shoved me to the side. "Idiot. Stop right there. You nearly got us killed, you simpleton." Orokin hurled posh insults one after the other, blathering something about a debt. I interrupted him. "Orokin, shut it. What is it that went wrong?" He gave a deep sigh. "Something in this fortress detected us, not long after we left on that maglev. Large constructs, they instantly killed you and began firing upon all of us. They took out a dozen immortals, critically injured Trazin and that so-called chronomancer." He stared at Nehibkor very briefly. "Before they were brought low by your vanguard and the executioner." He gave a nod to Agatlet and Phileas. "And finished off by those ridiculous constructs of yours." He signaled to the scorpoids. I pinched my temples. What tipped them off? I looked around the room, and noticed the far greater number of forces. "Never mind, we were detected thanks to our numbers, weren't we? We debated a plan for a few hours. In the end we came up with a complex firing solution. The swarm of scorpoid already in the room were to move through the tunnels they made into the wall and get into position. We loaded up onto the maglev, first Scythe Agatlet and his fellow Lich Good Kemperates at the front with fuck off massive shields. Behind me were Phileas, Trazin, and 10 Triarch Praetorian armed with Rod of Covenant, all poised to blast. Both Nehakor and Orokin gathered together in a ritual to actually speed our shots up and increase our perception time. 30 immortals, two of which were mounted on a pair of mobile mounted Gauss destructors trained upwards. Lastly, we had a healthy helping of 10 Deathmarks, because why not? Before anything, I quickly ran back out of the platform. "Hold on, one last thing," I exclaimed. I raised my harp. "I won't sit here being useless. Now check this." I held my harp rocker style. Ubercarge primed and ready. With that final word, I strummed the waveform chord with such conviction I felt like I was Jimi Hendrix rocking out on stage. A sonorous pulse of electricity consumed the gathered host of Necrons. Their necrodermis alight with surging power, flickers of balefire raising and falling from their chest cavities as though they were breathing flames. I couldn't ask for a greater force. I jammed my hand into the slip and activated the maglev. It sputtered for a moment, like Orokin told us it would, before propelling us forward. We flew into the fog, every gun trained on a space above us. When we heard the pressurized hiss in slow motion, we opened fire. There had been an opening in the roof that had parted up ahead. I dialed back my chronosense to simply watch every shot fire off. I heard the crackling shots of warbling, sickly looking beams of energy from the Deathmark synaptic disintegrators, the beams already several meters ahead and leaving the speed up bubble of time around us. The Praetorians with rods raised, each letting out a popping cry of starlight unleashing a potent burning projectile. Shrieking hisses of venting superheated air as the streaming wall of gorse beamed in perfect synchronicity in a converging point. The horrid cacophonous shredding whine of twin meter wide beams let free from the gorse destructor platforms. In the end, I was blinded and deafened as the tunnel began to shine from the light of over 500 scorpioid units lighting the room with horrid shots from the particle beams from their weapon array. The drones only managed to fall a meter and a half above us before their existence was utterly and totally terminated from this reality and everyone adjacent to ours. We were excited for a moment, a few cheers from Trazin, and the immortals shouted out this victory. It felt quite gratifying. Nahabkor and Orokin let down their bubble, and I quickly patted Orokin's back. "See, look at that," I said with a bit of confidence. "You can do good yet, Orok." I didn't get to finish, as suddenly the maglev banked hard. The platform flew end over end off the rail path. We were sent flying in a sprawling mess across the chamber, the maglev crushing and slamming into debris and denting the black stone walls. After a few minutes we picked ourselves, most only had minor cosmetic damage. Nothing that wasn't instantly healed over by the balefire. We got a ping from the scout squad ahead. There was some serious monkey business. They were really chimping out, making all sorts of howler monkey sounds. It was about time I got to work. I looked around and collected the clumps of plant fibers. "Just a moment, folks. Defend me while I prepare something. I have to do a minor transmutation ritual." The group nodded and formed a phalanx around me. I started projecting my tour with Trazin onto the ground, speeding through all the recordings to find a certain moment. After a few minutes, I got the exact moments I was looking for. I had the moment where I had seen the family Jacaro eating the banana-like fruit. I pulled up the dozens of scans I had done on it. I heard Trazin swear. "You plan on feeding these apes these fruits?" Trazin asked incredulously. I nodded and perked up. "Actually, Trazin, you have a sharp memory. Can you pull up every fruit you've seen the Jacaro eat and their chemical composition?" He was left speechless for a few minutes, before sending me over a fruit basket worth of data. I chuckled to myself, and got to work on working on an alchemization ritual. It took around a half hour to alchemize an entire shanty town's market's worth of fruits. Converting the energy I had stored in my resurrection orb into matter was an easy way to speed the process. Using the plant fibers and some transmutation, we had gotten several foodstuffs that would make any Jacaro go bananas. I got weird stares for making monkey base puns to myself every few seconds. I didn't care. This was too funny. We progressed onwards, eventually reaching the area with all the bits of iconography of Slan. Orcoid, I let Trazin just clear out the room in a labyrinth this time. I was of a singular mindset at the moment. We finally met with the scouting party. When I peered over the edge, it was vertigo inducing and I quickly reeled back. "Gosh, and they just live in that ship floating in the middle of all this?" I said with slight panic. Trazin started on Jacaro behavior, but I turned him out for once. "Alright, we need to get their attention somehow, preferably not violently. kinda get the feeling they might run the show in this fortress right now. The group remained quiet. Trazin, do you have any Jacaro audio files you can share with me? Trazin nodded and Orokin made a remark I didn't bother to listen to. After Trazin sent me a dense data packet of what sounded like a howler monkey's mating cry, I gave my vocal emitter a few tests. I had trained and modified my own throat to allow me to replicate sounds from memory. I gave a few bestial grunts. Is there a point to this? Why not have Trazin just place them into a labyrinth? I have seen him steer quite larger items than this in his labyrinths. Orokin grunted. I scoffed. Orokin, you were on a hot streak, but it seems I have to clue you in on something. None of what we have seen is standard. From the holes lanced in the nigh impenetrable Blackstone, the dead Kroaks, the collection of space hulks, the spindle drones leaving the fortress in our care. It's clear to me that these are the source behind these curiosities, and perhaps a method to avoid the anomalous defenses of this fortress. That gives him something to think about. In the meantime, I walk near the edge and let the ape-like groans of the Jacaro slip free from my vocal emitter. The booming huas and ha-has, bouncing and echoing off each surface, it was simian sounds and stereo. The group must have thought me mad when I took the hunched low stance of the apes. But I did not concern myself with such thoughts. Instead, I watched the ship stir in its place and saw a singular Jokiro swing off cables with little care of the danger of falling into the chasm below. It was rapidly scaling the walls towards me and my group. A strong sinewy ape swung before us. It was small, child size. It held up its finger rings towards me, as if about to blast me. I heard each pattering slap of its feet as it came closer. And quickly, it swiped a banana from my loose grasp, and quickly peeled it with its 3 feet. It gave the fruit a sniff, before scarfing it down greedily. It lowered its ring and just started taking as many fruits from my grasp as it could hold in its grip. It hugged several pomegranate-like fruits under its chin and scurried to the edge of the pit, and let out a series of howls. I can only hope it liked the fruits. Shortly, the collection of Jacaro came stampeding out of their little ship. It was a total of 6 of them. Complex machinery implanted in each of their spines, many ringed fingers, strange goggles and wires strung about their small frames, all but one. There was one that was incredibly imposing, as tall as me, just by being on all fours. His fur was immaculate, his every limb covered in muscle. This apex ape sized me up. Instead of plucking fruit from my grasp, it reached out for my wrist. My guards were about to strike, but I halted them with my free hand. The fruit I had been hugging to my body tumbled to the ground as he pulled my arm toward his face. He was observing the several digital rings on my left hand, the ones Trazin had given me 4 centuries prior. The great ape let out a babble of grunts and howls that I couldn't for the life of me understand. He turned me around to face one of the Kroak corpses and he quickly thumbed the activation button on the ring. A concentrated superheated beam surged outward, striking a wall. Rings of thermal energy feverishly followed after the beam, cooking the air around where the beam had traveled. The wall had been melted. I didn't even know Blackstone could melt. And for all that, my own finger was only a few degrees hotter after that. This greatly pleased the ape as it showed me its maw of teeth. Lips pulled back to show gums. I was momentarily disturbed, but I gave it a quick approving nod. The ape picked up a spiky melon and took a seat before me. For some reason, I felt like he was trying to talk shop with me. I took a seat before the patriarch ape. The ape didn't bother peel his fruit and instead chew through the skin or peel of his fruit. He held up a fruit gesturing to me and made a hand sign with his free hand. It is almost like a form of sign language. Oh, yes, the fruit. I paused and began to project a vid capture of the lush biomes from my Tom world. This caught his attention. He gestured for a few points on the planet that I assume he enjoyed. Do you want to live there? He gave a nod, and we continued. He wanted more food, passage out of the Blackstone, and something else. The patriarch ape pointed to a few units around the room. Each of them happened to be the units I had constructed, the weapon platforms, the Canoptech constructs, and some of the new Gorse weapons. He paused and took something from his back. An intricate clockwork device. It gave its own projection. The projection showed dozens of blueprints, machines being built and then each base component coming apart. You want me to provide you with resources to build? I made a few projections to try and depict that process. The patriarch howled and gave a happy nod. I gave a nod in return. Things were going pretty well so far. But there is something we want. I began to make several projections. Images of the Blackstone operations, moving, flying, traveling along the Sea of Stars. I showed me and my countless constructs repairing destroyed halls. I projected each relic that was once in piles of heaps in organized displays, everything neatly stored within a museum. I want to repair the fortress. I offered the ape a hand. No tabletop RPG is complete without beautiful models on the table, and the best place to get models is from us. If you check the link below, we have everything you could need for your magical realm. Only the finest of big titty wafers here. But if you're not into models or don't play with models, we got you covered with subclasses such as the Gachimashi Wizards, the Simp Warlock and the North FC Fighter. Also, we have started selling 5th edition adventures, with our first one featuring Belle Delphine, the succubus that has poisoned the town's well and turned the villagers into simps. If any of that stuff sounds fun to you, go ahead and check the link below, but let's get back to the video. He remained in deep compilation for several minutes. Even his clan of siblings remained mostly quiet, save for the wet juice filled bites into the sweet fruits. The patriarch was in deep meditations, occasionally running a thumb over his projection device. He flipped the device on and showed me projections of the drones and a few other constructs I wasn't aware of. Did you reactivate them? I was left shocked. Have you been trying to reawaken the fortress? He answered by showing hundreds of systems and mechanisms of the fortress. I heard a stream of expletives coming from Orokin, Trazin, and even the reserve Nehabgor. So you are in possession of one of the fabled augurs of despair. That likely wasn't its name. This device reminded me of an item I had seen in one of the audio dramas, Blackstone Fortress, Augur of Despair. A story bearing a device with mapping features into the fortress, along with who knows how much data on its inner mechanisms. Phileas spoke out, I think surprised herself. You know of such a device, Ishka? I nodded and returned to look upon the patriarch. I thought for a moment longer before making a projection of the drones. Do you know of these constructs? The patriarch stamped his chest with his closed fist and pointed to himself. No. Does he mean? I added the ape himself to projection, making it seem as though he was commanding the Guardian and Spindel drones. The ape nodded solemnly. Orokin snapped. So this primitive was responsible for killing Yo. I leveled a stare at Orokin and shut him up. Forgive me, my colleagues are difficult sometimes. The terms are acceptable. We restore the Blackstone together free from harm and you will be free to move about my planet with more resources than you can dream of. I made several projections on the ground between to illustrate the meaning of my words. He seemed content with this. I offered him my ringed hand. And the patriarch took it, giving my hand a firm shake, his kin jumping and hollering in joy no doubt. They brought up their ship from the hole. The thing was massive. But looking at it, it seemed to be the perfect dimension to slip through the halls. They invited me into the ship, ensuring the others would not follow. The inside of their space was a mess of a lived-in workshop. Every colorful surface held half-dissected weapons, strange welding instruments, and an unorganized collection of parts littering every table surface. They had small spaces, grooves between tables, with cushioned spots for them to rest upon. I saw the source of the plant fibers. They had a small tree. It seemed to be steadily growing fibrous fruits. They would drop down into baskets. They had been feeding upon this kiwi-like fruit. There wasn't much else for them in the area to eat. The patriarch ape showed me off to the lower deck of the ship. There was a series of strange Blackstone consoles and other Jacaro systems cobbled together to form a large holofield interface. The grate rose to his full height. He was nearly 9 feet tall upright. What had this roided up ape been doing to get to this bulk? He began quickly working on the holofield, flicking away unnecessary data and bringing up several floor plans. Not floor plans, individual chambers in the Blackstone Fortress. He retrieved his clockwork device, removing a small black stone pyramid from within. He slipped the black stone device into a small slot in one of the Jakero machines. The machines buzzed with data, and all across the projected chambers new images flared to life, overlaying on the existing map. Controls to summon up drones, or as it seemed, to deactivate them. You found a way to hotwire the old system. He thumbed an alien rune on the display, and the eyes of each drone went dark. He had deactivated the drone systems. My jaw would have hit the floor had I been capable. After a few minutes I pulled up my own projection. I asked him to lead us to the heart of the Blackstone. He paused and turned to his display. Going over his systems he began pulling up a wider view of the Blackstone snaking networks. And presented a map leading to the innermost section of the Blackstone. But it seems as though he had no control over the centermost corridors of the fortress. That was still a hundreds or so miles worth of fortress that we would have to look through, but this was excellent. The reason why I hadn't just bore into the central column was I had no idea what I could be damaging in the process. But now we had a crystal clear path to get to the center without damaging the fortress. I looked over the charts, following the pathways, making a mental copy. He led me out, and asked that all of us follow his vessel. I nodded and was placed back onto the ledge. The Jakero ship floated into the hall, now awaiting us. Fuck. How was I going to get all these Necrons to the other side? I remembered for once I had my harp. I surged power from my orb matrix, and strummed the fortification chord. The blast of sonic force transmuted the ledge, extending it out halfway over the pit. And it solidified into a long archway. I continued along the pathway, and in a few minutes I had a perfectly stable and sturdy blackstone walkway into the next chamber. The warriors followed after me as we moved at the behest of the Jakero ship. I could swear I heard Orokin curse me under his breath. I didn't mind much. We traveled for several hours. The ship was in constant motion. We could see that the halls had been painstakingly cut in ways to allow the ship to move freely. Just how long had these Jakero been denizens of this ship? Questions for later. Occasionally they would warn of us snares or other traps laid out. Pressure plates, or unstable floors. After 2 weeks of walking through hundreds of chambers, myriads of maglevs, untold machinery, mountain-sized pyramids, and so many more constructions within the Blackstone we were nearing the inner sanctums. We reached a long chamber, one whose every surface was polished to a clear reflective sheen. My mind was buzzing with static, constantly drumming with it. It was pulsing louder the more I stood in the room. My legs didn't move by my own will, I broke from the rest of the group. Something in these walls called to me. I stared into a billion of reflections. None of them a Necron. I stared into a face I had not seen in 472 years. I was staring into my own reflection, not Aishka, but my human face. I touched my reflection, looking over my every feature. My messy hair, my eyes' mundane color, the pigment of my skin, the length of my nails, the shape of my arms, the small gut I had. I wasn't much of a looker, but it was a body I could be myself in. I felt hungry. I wanted to head back downstairs and have some leftover donuts. I saw my reflections walk through my old home, calling off to someone else. Muffled though it was, I could hear myself speaking. I saw my younger sister walking to the fridge. I reached for her but my hand hit the wall. No, my reflection walked to my mother, asking if she'd like to visit the park later in the day. I even offered to invite my older sister. We could have my nieces and nephew join us. The reflection blurred for a moment. Things changed. I saw another human thing. No, a chaos thing. I saw a bone-thin thing covered in brands of each of the blighted chaos gods. It had my facial features but it was so changed. The thing that was me but not, was adorned in warped Terminator war gear, every edge sharpened for deadly intent. I was wielding a twisted blade, it radiated with vile energies, screaming faces warping across the surface. My blade was known as Dragnion, a prize I had claimed in ages long gone. I was amongst my congregations of Neverborn brethren, my horrid demons scheming, whispering, and constantly offering up horrid powers. A greater bloodthirster demanding I let them slip free to murder Bale. a lord of change asking that I direct its Aeon acceptor to burn Fenris. A putrid and great unclean one asking me to bring virus bombs to Makrag. A sensual keeper of secrets offering itself to me so that I may break Medusa. I scoured the lot of them. We had the Blackstone to claim. My vision blurred and reality shifted. The reflection I saw was human. Different from my own. Head shaved, Aquila emblazoned upon its forehead. I saw him toiling up a near endless stream of stairs. Banners of billions of houses. An endlessly massive ceiling for which I could not see extended beyond anyone's comprehension. Rows of martyr skulls lie upon plinths leading towards the massive golden mural in the distance. The Eternity Gate was a spectacle which few denizens of the Imperial Palace would ever have the privilege to look upon. Spiral mosaics, the snaking form of a draconic beast, falling by the will of the master of mankind, cherubs already singing his praises. I wept as I continued up the endless stairs, my legs in agony as I climbed. The great knights of golden radiance nodded to me as I was somehow moving closer to that beautiful door that no human deserved to ever pass through. I was to meet with his lordship of holiest terror. As I finally reached the top of the staircase, his master's custodes guided me along into the inner sanctum. I came to tell my lord of Starforts. My eyes blinded by the golden light that overtook me. I was elsewhere, dozing off. I was Azurani, my long ears, my slender form, the great robes that adorned my body. I was lazing on a field of grass, looking off to the domed ceiling. The void outside of the craft world a beautiful but terrifying expanse. I could hear the stamping footsteps of my venerable ancestor, and another. The first construct of wraith bone, and coal gemstones, a wraith seer looking at me. The second, a Bonasinger, she was a close friend. The trio of us spoke for hours, speaking of the future, talking on all matters of possibilities. I spoke of a black gift in the void, the talismans of Vol. That reality faded from me. For unknown times I stared, I saw into a billion realities, some not my own. Cups held within hands, mothers comforting sons, bones shaped in new ways, ships feeding upon worlds, souls merging into others. My head rocked, vibrating, pulsing with infinite reality. I felt I was dying, losing myself in the endless sea of possibility. Every audiobook, every anthology, every animation, every collection, every codex, every core rulebook, every drama, every miniature, every PDF, every poster, every series, every store. All the information I had known about this reality pulsed painfully through my brain all at once, each fighting for dominance. One line pounding loudly above all. A passage from a book I had purchased in a different time. It is a dimensional mirror, said Alpha Primus. We see a representation of reality as it might have been, had fate taken another course. I had stared into an abyss and it had stared back. Agakat and Phileas tore me from the mirror, reality struggling to take a hold of me once more. Why were they unaffected? I could feel my chest heaving, breathing heavily. These were unconscious actions I took, left over from when I still drew breath. They were trying to grab my attention, but my ears were still ringing with static. I was tossed atop one of the grav platforms and quickly moved towards the exit. I could still see reflections in the ceiling as we made way for the doors. Life as a Harlequin, learning esoteric laws and plundering the depths of the Black Library. A cunning and brutal life as a mech boy, assembling dozens of rollers fit for a wag boss. A long life serving under the Emissary, fighting against the Dark Prince's forces to claim the last Crone Sword. A neutered existence floating in amniotic fluid as I waged war as Warhound Titan, laying waste to hundreds with a single devastating blast from my turbo laser array. A ghost within a shell, a suit of sky blue ceramite armor, bringing warp fire to all those of Fenris. A short survival under the greater good, I was to mount an offensive within Torna Supremacy armor, to defend my home world from the oncoming swarm. A debauched existence as a Genestealer hybrid, procreating, adding to the family, the four-armed emperor would be pleased as my progeny spread beyond the stars. Life as a star god, gorging myself upon the souls of the god things of the Yieldery, succumbing the vitae fire from Cain the bloody-handed, new legions of Necron warriors rising from my new conquests, Tomb worlds by the thousands waking at my behest. One being soaring above the untold billions. Feasting and consuming all, butchering humanity with bioweapons and talent appendages. A wonderful existence as Tyranid Harridan. Endless existence, endless hunger, endless mind spanning the size of the universe. Chasing embers in the void beyond galaxies. A milky looking cosmos I plan to swallow whole. My consciousness slipped from me. Be Jacaro, patriarch of my small tribe of young. I am known as Fiori Vor, but to these young I am known as Elder Big One. My tribe was not always this small, and I was not always known as the Elder Big One. There had been a time when there were other such tribes within the fortress, each held dozens of our kinds. When inspiration and ingenuity were in great supply, generations of my kind have lived and died in the Blackstone. In time before even my eldest ancestors, we were told of our forefathers breaking free of the shackles of the Kroaks and defending their homes from their slower dim-witted ancestors. That was another age. We had lost many generations amongst the last elders. And all I have to show for my many years is the inspiration of others, their ancient and knowable creations filling my own form. I have held on to the relics of the tribes long gone. The vessel of Agraham Cash and his tribe's last son. The body of Marashorik and his tribe's two young daughters. The aegis of inspiration of the elusive and insane Bratrocert and his sickly son. My tribe's wellspring of fiber fruit, and my great-grandson. Bratrocert had claimed his inspiration would not stop, claiming he had found a ceaseless muse. A device born of the stone, the aegis of inspiration. A machine for which he claimed could be used to move this stone we had called home. In his madness he went into isolation, altering and dealing with machinery not meant for the hands of us. This device was made by a most wrathful and long gone creator whose name is lost to us. The stone we had called home from generations had been tormented, its long dormant defenders stirring. One by one the tribes fell as all manner of changes afflicted the home we had known. Changing it, removing the rules that governed it. Stripped us of the defenses that had made us capable of living in such a place. Forces had mustered against Bratrocert, and I had donned the body of Mereshorik, swelling my form with unnatural physique and killing the fiend Bratrocert, but those that had joined me in the war had lost their lives. Many more died before I discovered how to wrest control of the Aegis of Inspiration. I had created a safe haven, but those who would inherit it were few. Years came to pass us by and we have used the Aegis of Inspiration to gain new insights into the fortress. We could conjure forth its guardians for our own usages. We discovered inner sanctums, thought lost by our ancestors. We traveled across the Blackstone, merely surviving. The inspiration of my ancestors lost to us. So long had we been in the fortress we began to believe a quiet existence in the derelict fortress was all that was left for us. Until an ancient enemy came to the fortress. Constructs made of a strange metal and weapons made of the stone of the fortress. We had motes of knowledge of them, genetic memory of them, but I dared not start war with them if I did not need to. So I hid my family deeper, prepared many traps. Almost all were easily avoided or outright ignored by these individuals, and so when they came in greater numbers I summoned the drones. Two drones was not enough. I was readying the group to leave but their numbers were far too much. We would not be able to escape. I removed the brakes on the maglev, and allowed it to crash hoping it would slow them. These machine men, we could not see them on our monitors, only picking them up on motion sensors tucked within the walls. I was preparing the systems of the vessel, readying for war, when the Cert the Younger left the vessel, called by the sound of another Elder Jacaro. I did not believe it. He communed with the Metal Warrior, a leader of theirs, and called to us. The Metal Man had brought blessed nutrition, a confectionery meal, something that had no reason to smell so sweet. My kin ate happily, joy overcame them. I had forgotten the look of their smiling faces. I would make a deal with this sage enemy. As I made my approach, something caught my attention, this mono-eyed enemy. He wore a ring of a forefather, so intricate in design, so inspired in its beauty. I took his hand and released the devastating force upon one such wall. The beam that it had fired was some sort of maximized thermal lance that would reduce any to naught but liquid. With the ring of the ancestors, I approved of him. taking a seat and gorging myself in the sweet and tangy sourness of these fruits. We spoke of dealings, promise of blue skies, vast organic foliage, a planet where we would be free, the promise of even more of these sweet fruits. My kin eating away were at the verge of tears, my grandson sniffing, mucus leaking from overstimulated senses. I couldn't not refuse and indeed asked for more. I asked for access to his constructs, more resources, other means of inspiration so that my kin and their descendants may prosper. We spoke at further length, and I showed him the power of the Aegis of Inspiration. He was eager to learn from it, though he did not plan to take the Aegis from me. He instead had aims to restore the fortress. Generations of mine had tried to reach its innermost sanctum. But our cruel creator prevented us from ever entering its depth, the stories of less inspired minds plunging to their deaths trying to uncover the fortress's heart. But this man, this single eyes machine, showed me images of the fortress in movement, sailing the great sea of lights. This one could in fact awaken the great machine from its ages of slumber. He would bring our home of stone to his world. I showed them the way to the heart of our world and they followed us on the long journey to the core. They had little issue warding off the maledictions of the mind, or the other gravitational disruption. We did eventually reach the realm of reflection, one of the last chambers before reaching the Blackstone's heart. Many a great elder or foolish uninspired would come to this chamber in ages past to glimpse unknowables. Bratro Cert had been one such fool. His madness consumed him here. I did not believe these men of metal would succumb to this room's insanity, but from the safety of our ship we could no longer hear our companions follow. We headed to the next chamber and rapidly dismounted. The sage was entranced by the reflection. Me and my kin called, cried and screamed at his foolish allies to save him before madness would take him. They did eventually tear him away, but in the end he was babbling gibberish. He spoke in a tongue our genoforged minds instantly understand. Words of our ancient and forgotten creator, a tongue that no Jacaro had heard since the time before our forefathers. We dragged him to the final chamber, an empty expanse of nothing for which we could not enter. We directed them to a final gateway. His words of creation spilling out and lighting the shrouded room, mile-wide runes powering up. He was activating ancient and knowable machines with his words. What manner of old one could speak such powerful words? We could see the gateway opening. For a moment I considered stepping into the chamber, but recoiled instead. In the past we had seen any manner of life perishing trying to enter. Subservient races could not cross the threshold of this passage, not without whatever insight these immortals had. I saw them disappear into the gate. Need to wake up. Feel extremely cold actually, and everything feels stiff. When I finally take a peek around I find that I'm not alone. Two silver-colored skeletal figures stand to either side of me. Their backs to me, they haven't noticed me yet. It takes me a second to identify what the hell they are. Executioner Phileas and Trazin speaking to one another. Oh shit, it's this routine again. My head feels like it's been all over the place. I quickly surge a sliver of the power of the resurrection orb through my various subsystems and neural matrices to get me back to a good point. Nehabkor and Agak that spoke in unison noticing me sparked a life. Aishka has risen. The assembly of Necrons turned to me. Rubbing my temple I looked around. I wasn't out for too long was I? Orokin spoke up. A few minutes at best, we have reached the inner sanctum of the fortress. That got me up. We have traveled into this, he gestured to the chamber around us. It was an expanse of stairways and battered expanses of dilapidated columns. I could hear a tune playing in the distance, though no one else seemed to hear it. Was the Blackstone singing to me? The tune was fragmented, but still had a somber mood. I directed the others to follow, instinctively shushing them. A white light filtered in from everywhere yet there was no discernible source. We climbed past ruined statues, of indiscernible nature. Shattered walls. Blasted through and erased any information, I silently threatened to not dare touch anything. We walked along ancient walkways, marked with runes of which my mind occasionally guessed at. The others kept asking me what I was saying, claiming the words I was speaking were turning the fortress on. I didn't know what they were talking about, and kept pressing onwards, room's lighting with each step I took towards the furthest depths of the fortress. We're reaching the end now, the site of a final station on the horizon. More we traversed. Ancient blackstone weapons, positively charged, discarded. Husks of reptilian skeletal things sat sentinel every few dozen miles. Trazin said something about the slan, to which I did not respond. The song was growing louder now. The fortress had heard me say something after I stared into reality. It thought I was its master, come to finally claim her, to restore her. The consoles were many, ancient mechanisms made for greater hands than mine. Colossal creator deities once sat at these terminals, and so I took my seat upon them. I didn't know what I was doing, slipping my hand into massive slits in the surfaces. Feeling oily edges from within, I felt them suddenly solidify, my arms unable to move out. I told the others not to move and not to worry, and I turned the latches. Grills in some far distant ceiling came rushing down. Black oil came to drown us. Some fought it, others did not. The oil spilled over the edge, and I could hear the Blackstone song rise. We were overtaken by the Itcher, frozen in as every inch of this impossible room began to fill. I remained awake, unable to breath, but still able to think, and wait. I heard the voice of the fortress, its song still in my mind. Whispering to me its secrets, guiding me to bringing her online. I listened intently, what keys to enter, what dials to turn, what systems need fixing. Data streamed into my consciousness. Had it been my soul, or this metal brain that had gained this knowledge? All I could do was digest this knowledge, reciting in my mind what it was that needed to be done. And so we waited for the room to fill with the oil. For when it was full, reality would take hold in this chamber. And we waited for hours, so many of them, it felt like ages, weeks even. Then months came to pass, a century is how much time I had spent learning all there was. And then I heard the clinking metal of my cape rattle behind me, movement restored after a century of waiting. The other Necrons were confused, but I had no time for that. I had been possessed with insight. I wasted no seconds in quickly raising the machine awake. Pieces of my consciousness streamed into the myriad consoles as I stabbed my tail output into a newly made port in the terminal. These were ancient systems I did not fully grasp, but I was invigorated. I was learning this living system, conversing with it as I started it, a vast intelligence impossibly old. Together our consciousness meshed into one another, where a tech priest or her tech would have tried to overpower and work around the myriad of systems. I joined it, embracing it. Tectonic beauty of blackstone, metal, and far, far, far more held within it. A consciousness vast yet separated from the warp, possessing great machinery to manipulate it, the weave of reality with sciences and sorceries. With her enhanced touch I was able to assert my signal onto all of the scorpoids, canoptic constructs, and drones. Work was to be done to fully return her to operating capacity. Time dilation was removed from this chamber, and instead applied elsewhere in the fortress. The Jacaro had perhaps seen us leave only a few hours ago, but a full century had passed within this innermost sanctum. I informed the others that soon I would wake the fortress fully. They all questioned me, asking how I had done such, and why I had insisted on constantly uttering that unintelligible audio from my secondary vocal emitter. So that was where it was coming from. My mind had been altered after looking into the dimensional mirror. Mortal beings would have become confused and gone completely insane. Maybe I already had, or maybe I hadn't. My mind was already fractured. I commanded every construct to begin the great work. I ordered Nehebkor and Orokin, the two chronomancers, down to assist the constructs. Orokin raged against me, letting me know what he thought of him ordering me around. Phileas stopped him from hurling insults at me and had him go and do as asked, a threat of bodily damage. The two chronomancers were to cast the largest version of Zatath's harmonious sphere in the areas in which the canoptic constructs occupied during their works. I had already planted the complex miles worth of engram data into their matrices, meaning they would make quick work of repairing the ancient systems. Their time bubble would see that work be done within the fraction of the time. I ordered Phileas to gather all the metallic ships to one end of the ship. She half raised her relic war scythe to me, but let it go. All those resources would be needed to ensure the millions of years of plundering and damage would be undone. Phileas knew this, and opted to not murder me for once. As for Trezin, I asked that he capture the Jacaro and their ship within one of his tesseracts, and to bring them to me, as to allow them to assist me. When the Jacaro released within the command center, they were in awe. They had been given access into the heart of the fortress command space. They would help for a scant few decades, helping construct additional command terminals, and allowing me to take possession of their so-called Aegis of Inspiration. I had more intimate control of the defenses of the outer sections of the fortress's defenses. After the first century, we had pulled the hulks into range of the fortress's grip and dismantled the clusters of Orchid and Xenos vessels, leaving only the organic vessels and that of the Yieldery. The second century had ensured Nehakor and Orokin had sped up the process of restoring the damage that racked the many facilities and the power network. Both Chronomancer had spent well over a millennia worth of effort to maintain the bubble and speed up the work to our perception. The third century saw the Jacaro returning to a tesseract, and had seen every vessel not in search of the other fortresses brought into the Starfort. The fourth century saw to it that we had brought its ancient shields and tractor beams online, which were promptly used to bring every single non-organic ship into our Starfort for diction and resource acquisition. And 72 years after that, the Blackstone was awoken, a 572-year affair for us Necrons, and a far longer time for our Chronomancers. After the Blackstone was awoken, my mind haze and the voice fortress evaporated. It had been intoxicating. I suppose I understood Orokin more when he had the voice of Vishani guiding him in the infinite and the divine story. All that knowledge went to my head. And it started hitting me in waves how much I had fucked up. Yes, the Blackstone Fortress is operational now, but I nearly got myself killed ordering both Orokin and Phileas around. I apologized to Phileas, informing her I simply lost myself in all the research I had been conducting. The fortress had compromised my better judgment for a period. When I approached Orokin, he seemed impatient. Now then, I believe you owe me some answers. I have incurred two life debts reversing the timeline to allow you to still annoy me with your continued existence. Orokin snapped. I let out a drawn out sigh. Yes, I suppose after this endeavor you will start helping yourself to all the research you can find to start your path to achieving that form of light. There will be a thought form being that will come to reside within you, Orokin. One who will push your studies into the heights of astromancy, chronomancy, datamancy, and finally voidmancy. When the stars are just right, you will be able to achieve this form, but you need to read up on many texts. The Vishanic manuscript's digital copies will be a guide for you, Orokin. You will only read them. I will be the one to decide when you are ready to collect any trinkets to progress your studies. The pursuit of planets and artifacts from other dynasties will be forbidden to you, Orokin. And to ensure you don't go looking where you don't belong, I've prepared something. I tap my throat, playing an audio clip from the infinite and the divine. A consequence of things to come should Orokin follow the path of a scoundrel. Orokin ran a hand over his chin. The Vishanic manuscripts. I am unfamiliar with these texts. I snickered. The Immunus dynasty is where you will find such records. I'm warning you now. Trying to seek out that dynasty's mysterious will only propel you to a violent end, or corruption. I flashed a projection of a depiction of Orokin as a flayed. The image unsettled him, turning his ocular away, warding his face from the horrific image. He hurriedly lowered his arms, trying to return his composure. That can't be. I have closed myself to such possibilities. This was true, but scaring him with this light could steer him clear of doing something stupid. I hammered the lion further. There are only a handful of Necrons who are immune to the viruses, and I can assure you, you are not one of them. This gave him a lot to think about. With last minute tests settled and final preparations made, I headed back to the bridge of the Starfort. My void crew, pilots, and a Gaghat, my personal lich good of all people, would help me pilot the great vessel. Its lower half moved in counter to its upper half, and after a single slow rotation the vessel began to move onwards. Once more I connected my input into a port in the console. I informed the ship we were in search of her five other sister starforts within the systems, letting her know that they were all alive, Power on, but defenses most likely in a state of disrepair. She informed me with her restored systems she could indeed locate the other fortresses within a certain range. The power of our combined augurs could double our sensor sweeps to an area of around 1,000 light years. We could maybe find another fortress in a relatively short amount of time. Holy shit, it's... Is this how Abaddon was able to pinpoint where each of the fortresses were? We sailed for several decades before we received one ping. Our sensors picked up something at the very edge of our auger sweeps. A slight fluctuating power signatures. These readings were consistent with what information the ship's databanks had on other fortresses. We closed in on the fortress with all haste. Life signs were picked up, a few hundred of them actually. We also picked up ship signs. There was Ildari abroad. Fuck, how did these bitches come across one of these? We closed in on the Gethsemane subsector, stopping our approach at the edge whatever scanning arrays could be done. I pulled my input from the command console, slamming a closed fist hard on the surface. This was seriously bad. We cannot let the Ildari get a single fortress, especially during their height of power. This isn't fair. They weren't supposed to know anything about this. I let out a deep breath, trying to regain my composure as I turned to face Phileas. My executioner, permission to break the informal non-aggression act with the Ildari. I blurted. My chronoscence whirred hard, trying to make a follow-up that would appeal to her wants. With her being a constant presence in my life for these centuries, I think I've gotten a good idea what kind of person she is. How like most of the Praetorians, she so desperately wants to see her empire thrive, even if she has a funny way of showing it. That and murder. She very much likes the idea of murder. She hasn't managed to kill anything beyond all these video game simulations. I quickly followed my previous sentence with if only to claim something that by all rights should belong to the immortal empire. She couldn't emote her murderous glee, but I think the slight chuckle I heard for a fleeting second was evidence of that enough. You have my approval and my blade to engage. Phileas said. Agactatan had identified a trio of Phoenix battlecruisers, a duo of hellebore frigates and several other craft. That actually surprised, oh fuck. I was too thorough with my in-depth implantations of every single ship within all the Battlefleet games, both the tabletop and the two video games, not to mention extensively tweaking and adding all the ships from the Rogue Trader, Battlefleet Chronos, not to mention all those other smaller books with their rules. I had been unknowingly preparing my protector and the executioner Phileas over the many centuries for this mission without even knowing it. The pair taking the reins of the weapon arrays, already determining the flow of battle far before we had even entered the solar system. Phileas was already ordering a team of ships from her own reserves, planning to get our teleportation array to drop them off ahead of us. We were planning blitzkrieg tactics against the Ildari. If same hand could see us, they would shit themselves. Beavral Ulthrabal, Council High Fiser of the World Myrisilian, and devotee to the goddess of fate Mori Heg. They called me a madman. They said my visions of the future were insanity. My visions of the Cyclopean Necron had only grown more distressing. But when I predicted the wag of heavenly ascension with such precision and in such detail to guarantee victory, they came crawling back to me. I was quickly elevated to the rank of Farseer during the conflict, having been personally responsible for the destruction of 12 Greater Orcoid Fleet vessels from crashing down upon a vital mercantile craft world. After that, I had access to the greatest esoterica texts our world had to offer. For decades I researched the ancient text, finding counsel in the ancient Wraithseer ancestors, and glimpsing into the future. I have came of scarce set of text mentioning an artifact of a matching description. The name chilled my very being to say such a thing. The Talisman of Vol. During the war in heaven, there had been a form of grand alliance under the ancient creator race. Beings known as the Jacaro, Kanib, Krux, Rashan, Slan, and our race defended the once beautiful paradise of the galaxy from the Necron and their fiendish so-called star gods. In these texts it makes mentions of our god Vol, the god of smiths forging and aiding the creators on a powerful artifact. This artifact was said to reach within the realm of souls and spill forth a destructive beacon for all to see. And yet it was so much more than a weapon. True immortality, insights of the creator's means by which to spread life across the stars, untold wisdom. There were so many whimsical claims. But what terrified me was that I believed that it was that this tool of our creator and our god Vol could be claimed by the immortal enemy. My visions were concise in this manner. The ghost with one eye would claim these moon know the talisman of Vol, and with it, he could snuff out the Yieldery. And so I called forth favors. In just 2 decades I had assembled and personally overseen a competent fleet fitting of my station. 390 Guardian Defenders, 125 Black Guardians, 80 Canite Warriors, 55 Wraith Guard, 25 Wraith Blades, 20 Bonasingers, 18 Warlock Council Members, 10 Wraith Lords, 8 Wraith Knights, 4 Wraith Seers, 1 Phantom Titan. As for our fleet, it consisted of 10 Solaris class light cruiser, 5 Vol class cruisers, 3 Phoenix battle cruisers, 2 Hellebore frigates, 1 Void Stalker to lead them. With my great forces and several ancestral relics, we headed for the Void, a region of space greatly uninhabited by our people. Many webway gate trips later, we were deposited at the far foothold of the sector. My vision had told me a great enemy was present here, already in search to claim one of these talismans. And so we scouted, avoiding his legion's many scouts. We had plans to secure one of these talismans. No. Not one, but all of them. Before the wicked Cyclops could taint our god's works, I entered a deep mediation during our transit within the system. Assisted with the foresight and guidance of my warlock council and those of the venerable Wraith Seers. Trying to divine the location of one of these talismans is a difficult process. A decade without any luck. It didn't matter, we continued our divinations. I offered a quiet prayer to Moriheg before one such ritual. I felt our goddess's wisdom imparted on me. The talisman was orbiting a world rich in minerals, a fledgling solar system, devoid of sentient life forms. We rushed off, weary to not alert off the immortal enemy. We reached our destination within 4 years standard, avoiding much. The talisman brought many to tears, reaffirming to all of those doubtful of my claims that my work here was imperative. We disembarked into the fortress, keeping the trio of Phoenix cruisers and other frigates to guard the talisman whilst me and my combat force headed into Heart to awaken the talisman. When we stepped off our vessels inside the fortress, we soon found that even our most skilled Bonasingers were unable to make use of their talons against the strange substance that made up every surface of this star fort. Pressing on our vanguard of Wraithbloods took point, ensuring our safety. We ended up coming across areas of troubling concern. Rooms of oil, chambers without gravity, intangible walls that would allow ones to simply walk through them, chambers emanating undecipherable signals. Navigating this locale will be quite difficult. Rural is a great app available on the Apple and Google Play Store, as well as desktop, for creating beautiful 8-bit character art. The app has 14 supported races, 150 plus weapons, 400 plus armor pieces for you to mix and match, 20 plus mini bases. There is that much to work from. I was able to make Coldsteel the Hedgehog, the God Emperor of Mankind, Pepe, and they are always adding more artwork. The app also has a character sheet to help keep track of everything during games. And if that wasn't enough, you can play about with the app for free with limited artwork. So go ahead, check it out, and if you decide to buy the app, use promo code NICKBEARDIER for 10% off, and it lets them know we sent you. It's a great sponsor and a great app, and we hope you guys go ahead and check it. But let's get back to the video. Several weeks of travel saw to it that we were cut off from the outside forces. Our communications networks unable to pierce fortress, and shortway webway jumps within its walls proved fruitless. We accepted we would need to drip feed our fleet's information once we made return trips. What a fool we were. For the first time in a millennia, I was caught in the present so intoxicated by the lure of the talisman presence that I had not devoted myself to constantly view the future of my wider surroundings beyond the fortress. We had traveled for several weeks, quickly making way to the fortress's heart. We were still well packed on provisions, and would likely not need to return for another several months. But we had not received word from those of our collages from within docking stations of the Starfort. B. Executioner Phileas. Myself, Agakhot and the Void crew have taken operational control of the fortress. We began pulling in closer to the fortress. We would not give them the time to react. Activating the teleportation array, we engaged in deep strike tactics. A trio of Dirge class raider and another trio of Jackal class raider instantly transmitted above one of the Phoenix battlecruisers. Their opening volley of lightning arc batteries hammered at their shields, threatening to break through them. Before the Eldari had time to respond, the escorts allowed swarms of dozens of Doom Scythes to emerge. Each ship scattering across the surface of the Eldari's shield, firing off streams of energized beams from their twin-linked Tesla destructors and the devastating lancing beam from the Death Ray. In just under 2 minutes, the Eldari's shields had cracked. Enough time for the Mycairn class tomb ship to reach a range allowing it to unleash the force of its star pulse generator. A green ring pulsed from the tomb ship, rapidly expanding outwards. One of the Hellebore frigates tried to dive under it. The ring expanded and caught the back end of the nose-diving vessel and took the brunt of the pulse. The outline of its energy shield shattered, overloaded, and the pulse scrambled the rear of the frigate. It drifted dead for a moment. Fragments of the Wraithbone hull flew off. Indeed, we could see a large sweep had been torn from it and the pulse. The ring only expanded a small bit further before it impacted against the shields of the Phoenix battlecruisers. They held against the pulse, sparking momentarily, wounded but not defenseless yet. No matter, they would be dead soon. The two mostly undamaged Phoenix ships began adjusting their positioning, hoping to aim their pitiful pulsar cannons our way. Unthinkable, there was no chance to be given to them. Reposition, prepare to fire upon translations. My order was given. As the Eldari found themselves turning to line up a proper firing solution with their main batteries, a green energy formed around the tomb ship and three accompanying Scythe class harvest ship. Cracking fissures opened within reality, as each ship quickly erupted in an emerald light chow. The Eldari slowed there for a moment, trying to scree as to where they had gone. Instantly, the attack force appeared in a crackling explosion of green and reality fissures. The fleet had appeared beside them. A barrage of particle beams intersected, breaching the shield, scoring a sweep of disassembling energies. A counter hail of missiles and pulsar beams streaked across the amidst the particle beams. The Eldari were taking an offensive. Lesser craft began to swarm the individual Scythe class harvest ships, and begrudgingly quite effectively focusing fire faster than the ship's generators could hold with. The secondary Hellborn closing in. Before I had time to react, a torpedo crashed against one of the Scythe shields, popping its defenses. The Jackals were quick at work, tearing swaths of lightning arc beams across the surface of the first of the Phoenixes. The agile escorts weaving around its gigantic bulk, with the Phoenix too busy with trying to restore the shield, they were unable to add their pulsars to the fight. Several smaller attack craft were released to deal the Doom Scythes. This did not concern me in the slightest. I gave the order for the Carrion class tomb ship to let free its Night Shroud bomber aircraft. Only 10 were launched, quickly heading for the rear of the secondary Phoenix. As they took flight, two rapid bursts of pulsar beams connected to the defenseless Scythe ship, these streaks coming from the tertiary Phoenix, taking an entire wing of the ship, threatening the ship to go critical. This wound could not go unpunished. The Night Shrouds quickly dropped their payload of Death Spheres, rocketing down into the back of the secondary Phoenix. An implosion rocked the Eldari craft. The antimatter payload had impacted the ship, matter gathering before exploding outwards in gargantuan detonation all along the Phoenix, fragmenting like some primitive frag grenade. As a hail of what once a noble ship sprang out, its debris crashed into the second Hellborn, destroying and several smaller craft. More Eldari craft were approaching, 8 Solaris class and 5 all class cruisers. Perfect, the time was right. All forces began to mass retreat at my order. Each of them heading towards one nearby moon. They gave chase, trying to reach after and destroy the damaged ship. Our rears were being bombarded with pulsar lances and several seeking torpedoes. It wouldn't be long before our shields gave. They gave chase, predictably following in relatively close formations. The sustained battery from concentrated fire on our flanks broke through our shields, torpedoes lancing into the ships, taking large swathes from the tomb ship hull. This did not deter us. They continued their escape behind the moon, and by then I handed off fleet command to a Gakat. Instead I took control of something else in the Blackstone. We came out from behind the greater moon, our presence having been previously undetected. We were met by our fleet of ships, slightly damaged, Ildiri on their tail. The wretched Ildiri finally saw the glory of our own fortress, a fully active star fort. I could hear a Gakat ordering a translation of the fleet. Each of our fleet ships began to glow, cracks in reality formed around them, all of the fleet translating elsewhere. The Ildiri panicked, several of their lesser craft began to dive, while those more imbecilic of their kind began to charge upon us, and loading their weapon batteries. Their combined fire impacted up against our imposing bulk of shields, pitiful, barely able to reduce shield stability by 8%. I locked my aim upon the largest collection of Ildiri. Our cannons righted themselves onto the Ildiri as they continued fire. The system spooled, empiric energies charged through the center of the ship, coalescing into a conduit at the heart of the cannons. In a few short seconds we had reached sufficient power to fire. Reality shrieked, a banshee cry erupted outwards as the battlefield was consumed in the light of a volatile beam of empiric energies lanced into the cluster of Ildiri ships. The beam consumed each of their pitiful pulsar beams, star cannon pulses, and detonated every missile and torpedo before they could so much as glance at our shields. The volatile beam of deep fuchsia washing over the secondary Phoenix battleship, consuming it in a bath of lights and wicked arcs of warp energies, the ship detonated in a hail of Ryath burn and lights. The secondary's death throw explosion took its brother Phoenix ship's shield as it too was consumed into the sustained beam from our warp cannon. Several other Solaris class and Vol class cruisers were caught in the explosion, and in turn continued the chain of destruction. With all these detonations so close to one another, the tertiary Phoenix finally crumbled and capped off the first weapons fire test of the Blackstone Fortress with a hail of detonating Ildiri and ruins of psychically burnt Wraithbone fragments. Only two Solaris class light cruiser and a single Vol class cruiser survived the initial fire. A Gakat took great relish ordering the fleet to turn around and to fire all weapons upon the stragglers. The Ildiri pilot of the 5th Solaris light cruiser, a part of the Black Moon expedition, Farseer Ivralad Ulthrawil, called for the expedition shortly after her ascension to Farseer after the Wag of Heavenly Ascension. Her premonitions were heeded by those less skeptical minds than my own, and so she was granted permission to disembark with a moderately armed fleet. I, however, found irksome we would be calling forth the aid of one of the Phantom Titans. She claims such warriors would be needed against the immortal enemy, an enemy that even our ancestors have not needed to concern themselves with for nearly 40 million years. In any case, we sailed for just under a decade through the Webway before we were deposited out at an empty expanse of nothing. An uncharted, unwanted system, with nothing to speak of. Ivrala speaks of an artifact, constantly chattering on and on about a Cyoclean menace, moons, and the destruction of our people. She sent out several of our escorts and smaller scouting vessels ahead of us. How the Higher Council of the World found this blabbering so-called Farseer is beyond me. Even with her victories, I have no trust within this Ildiri. I was voicing my concerns with another fellow pilot when we were informed several weeks later that the scouts had found numerous strange scout vessels that our records noted as being Necron and design present. For 10 years we sailed and avoided hundreds of Necron craft. Constantly the council on board were in deep mediations and divinatory rituals. More Ahegs eyes, what future are they trying to glean here? Each day we risk being spotted by the hundreds of Necron scouting ships moving through the subsectors. More of our pilot brethren grew tired with all these vague messages and seemingly random paths we take. After several more months of this nonsense, she claims to have found this talisman artifact. We headed for a small solar system, coming before a planet rich in minerals. It was only after we moved behind the planet did we see the artifact that we had been searching for 2 decades. The Talisman of Vol. A fortress of smooth black stone, 900 or so miles across. The Farseer claims it was once under the control of the creator race and Vol himself. Our Bonasinas collectively offered no less than a dozen prayers upon seeing it. All but the trio of Phoenix battlecruisers and a pair of Hellebore frigates were ordered into the fortress. Those outside would be on the lookout for the immortal enemy. All of our forces were deployed within the fortress, and it was quickly we were informed that travel deeper into the fortress rendered communications null. They collected information and samples for weeks. We had much in the way of recorded captures of the insides of the Starfort, all of which was loaded upon a pair of Solaris-class light cruisers. They would inform our homeworld, and bring additional forces to claim this behemoth for the moon. This would be a great boon for the Ildiri Empire. 3 weeks after the light cruisers disembarked, we received warning beacons from the outside forces. The immortal enemy had translated above our trio of Phoenix ships, Isha weeps. How had they found us? They hammered down at our shields, unleashing swarms of smaller attack craft to thread around our guns. By the time the 8 other Solaris and the 5 all cruisers arrived, one of the frigates had been destroyed and the primary and secondary ships had their shields seriously damaged, if not outright brought down. With our aid we were able to make quick work of them, their defenses faltering. We caused critical damage to one of the 4 lesser crafts. We had lost a single Phoenix ship, but we would be the avenging sons to break our enemies. They could sense their defeat, and by Kane we were ensured victory. I cracked rapid rounds of pulsar beams upon their retreating flanks. I was responsible for shattering the tomb ship's pitiful shields. Kane's favor was upon me this day. Soon the immortal enemy's flanks were being broken, our torpedoes breaking their backs. Many glories were to be won this day. Horrors came before us. Another fortress appeared from behind the moon, alight with life, each deadly arm rotating in synchrony, like a clockwork mechanism. It wasn't the fortress we had arrived at, but another. What in the laughing god's poor humors was this insanity? The fortress seemed to draw upon the realm of souls, pulling psychic energies at unprecedented levels. How is this possible? Soon the entire fortress was obscured by the pure distilled psychic energies, funneling them all into a single deadly cannon arm. Fear took me, and I dove my ship downwards away from the fortress. My brethren above charged the massive ship. I was a coward, but at least I would still survive. The cannon continued to gather psychic energies, until its greedy stomach had consumed entire seas from the realm of souls. I could see it above me, the massive beam, wider than any of our frigates, wider the Phoenix ship, perhaps even greater our docked Void Stalker. One by one I saw each of our ships, consumed in the bright pinkish-violet lights, detonating, scattering like shrapnel, killing its own brethren in its death explosion. Fear and mania took my Void crew as I continued to steer us away. We could hear their dying transmissions, their pleas for escape, their death cries, their confusion. Such terror gripped me. Soon my world ended. My last thoughts lingered on fear of the fortress, fear of the talisman of all. We were not worthy to claim such a weapon. Be of Rala Ulthrewil. After several weeks of deep travel within the fortress, a collection of our warlocks have taken it upon themselves to decipher the encrypted messages emanating from the towers. Some of them claim it to be the very voice of Vol speaking to us, but I am weary of those beliefs. These signals were peculiar, a series of weak vibrations, electromagnetic waves, and lastly a series of low, barely perceptible psychic frequencies. I felt it more fitting to call this emanation a song, rather than a voice. No matter. I did not have the time for this drivel. Instead I pressed my group onwards into another oil-filled chamber. I did not relish in this all-consuming oil, but they were necessary to progress into the next chamber. I sunk my hand into the bowl of oil, my hand caught on a turn lever. I could not remove my hand from the bowl as the oil had hardened. The only option was to turn the lever. When I did so, the oils on the floor began to rise, trapping us in an immovable epoxy-like fluid. We waited for the chamber to flood entirely. I watched as our Wraith Lord companions were overtaken in the oil. Slowly the oil began to rise above them, slowly inch closer to the ceiling. When the oil settled at the ceiling, I once felt the light clinking of my band of gemstones at my hip. Movement was restored and we could travel deeper into the fortress. We would need to rest soon and mark our findings. For many more hours did we walk, looking for a chamber my host of warriors could rest, and to meditate on our findings. The perils we fought were that of a physical nature. We had come across no enemies Rose speak of. The complex geography of this landscape boggled the mind. Even simply moving to another chamber took great effort to traverse. Thin corridors that went for miles, impossibly deep chasms with dozens of connecting chambers, skeletal walkways of endlessly branching pathways, and confoundingly vertical hall chutes that went up entire miles. All sense was to be lost in its construction. Some within my host believed this complex maze of structures to be a test of sorts. It was. One of the Kanite warriors in my group said its construction was a means by which to judge those found unworthy to claim the talisman, and they called me mad. We eventually stopped down into a room with another mountain-sized pyramid. We would have moved on to the next chamber, but progressing onwards would be troublesome. The next chamber was a long moat of brackish tar-like oil, a lake worth to be crossed. We would settle near the base of the pyramid, once more looking over our force, ensuring we had not lost any of our warriors. 50 guardian defenders, 45 black guardians, 25 wraith guard, 15 canite warriors, 10 wraith blades, 5 bonasingers, 5 warlocks, 4 wraith lords, and a singular wraith seer. The maximum one could fit on a maglev together. There were other expedition teams taking their own paths through the Blackstone. I could no longer feel their psychic presence. They were too far for me to sense them. I sat myself down against the pyramid, trying to enter into a meditative. That would not come to pass, as the Wraith Seer would come to speak to me. Venerable Wraith Seer spoke within his reverberating echo of a voice. Farseer, I am troubled. These chambers grow more and more archaic in their construction. Its geometry and symbology are utterly alien to our own. I caution your optimism for this place lest it becomes our tomb. I chuckled at this. Your caution is ill-founded, venerable one. Thus far its geography has been all that we've need to concern ourselves in. You have become too lax, too used to passage between the webway, or traveling atop a ghostlance. While yes, the traveling has been taxing, a bit of physicality does us good. Be at ease, my friend. I gestured the Wraith Seer take a seat beside me. We spoke for several hours as I ate my rations. Though my meal was soon interrupted by a blabbering warlock. I've figured it out. The warlock shouted. I climbed to the peak, to better perceive the meaning of the message. The song of this. The warlock struggled for a moment. Blackstone. Yes, the song of the Blackstone. There is a psychic message hidden within the Blackstone Pyramid's signals. I rose to my feet. What did you hear? The warlock spoke with a frantic excitement. It's a warning, a call to retreat. I balked. A retreat? He clarified further. The words are complex, not something we would recognize. It was more of a complex series of emotions, images, and sensations. He spoke manically and frantically. I felt from the message, some sort of enemy was abound, something they could not defeat. The gravity of his words had set in for him, and his voice became a low hush. Whoever once walked this hall's long since left, and I posit they were the ones who left this warning to its brethren. There was more to be heard, but this was all I could comprehend. Be executioner Phileas. Our efforts into the Blackstone have proved fatal. Multiple instances where our first fleet vessels were instantly gunned down any ships that tried to enter the Blackstone. A shrieking tear of empiric beams not all too dissimilar to our own warp cannons. Pearling upon the dawn of war data logs of Ildari phenotypes and arsenal. What we were witnessing was eerily similar to a large-scale distortion cannon. There are several Ildari vessels armed with D weaponry. I narrowed it down to the rarely used Ildari Phantom Titan. After the fifth failed attempt reset by the Divine Reichska halted us, proposing a rather alien strategy. A tactic I found intriguing. He advanced the fortress closer to its new counterpart. He and Orican worked quite well together to orchestrate this bizarre maneuver. Six of my own Jackal-class raiders would be racing through the chambers of our fortress, quickly gaining rapid momentum. They spiraled around the teleportation gate while it spooled up. Each of these Jackals were filled several Night Shroud primed to blow. When each Jackal had reached peak momentum, they sharply turned into the now activated gate, rocketing several miles into the opening. Having been teleported well inside the open passage of the fortress, the Titan had no time to fire off at the group of jackholes. We could see it all on our deck monitor. The jackals were greeted by a stationary void stalker for Wraith Knights, and at the head of it all an imposing Phantom Titan, charging its distortion cannon. Walls of solar beams, pulsar blasts, and other blasted eldery projectiles hailed towards the jackals. Most were able to bank down hard, avoiding the slew of killing shots, but two jackals powered through. The lead jackal avoided an Empyric blast, encircling the devastating reality-rending beam before crashing into a pair of the Wraith Knights. The resulting blast imploded in on itself, sucking in every fragment of cracked Wraith bone before combusting outwards in a flechette spray of antimatter. Two Wraith Knights demolished at the cost of a single ship. The Eldari quickly realized our aim was not to enter into any form of standard warfare, but by then it was too late. The second and third jackal surged for the center mass of Titan. The second hit its mark while the other was split in half by the heft of the Titan's immense power glaive. But it was for naught. Upon connecting, the shattered form of the jackals imploded, bringing forth every fragment of its destroyed, before the baleful wellspring of antimatter hailed outwards. The titanic glaive was sundered, its long blade quickly being erased from existence. The Titan let out a horrific wail, dropping its massive melee armament to clutch its punctured chest cavity. Another detonation came around it as a single jackal was detonated before it could land, but the size of the explosion was simply too all-consuming that it obliterated another Wraith Knight. The Titan wildly sliced the air, letting out an arcing beam from its distortion cannon. The crescent beam tore through the air, shredding away at the form of one jackal. The resulting mix antimatter and empiric chaos sent shockwaves of concussive force tossing the Titan and the remaining Wraith Knight near tumbling. With this moment of uncertainty, the final jackal flew straight into the Phantom's impossibly massive head, but rather than detonating outright it continued. The jackal dragged the Titan's body half a mile before it made impact into the Void Stalker. The jackal's shields popped as it buried itself deeper and deeper before it too went critical. Its antimatter payload detonated a third of the way into the ship before our screens went dark. The devastating kamikaze tactic had proven expensive but indispensable against such a loathsome enemy. I turned to the rest of the on-bridge crew. We shall be entering the fortress with a full force to root the Eldari. We came in full force. I had called upon 100 of those of our most honor-bound group. Armed with my relic war scythe and an apotheosis orb, I was more than equipped for the slaughter ahead. We came in legions, coming to break those vermin that still persisted in the Void Stalker. They did not surrender, nor beg for their pitiful lives. Instead, those that survived the destruction foolishly chose to take up arms against us. A pitiful collection of guardians, warlocks, and Kainite warriors. They left like volleys of shredding shuriken fire, bouts of reality-splitting warp fire, and a flensing torrent of blades. We met them with murderous indifference. I surged to the front lines, weaving between our own shots from the Gorse Destructor beams. These blasts reduced a rank of shuriken gun-wielding guardians to a steaming cloud of red mist. One emerald-clad Kainite warrior met me with a challenge. Leaping forward in a pounce, he wished to sink his demi-cleaves into my head. I slowed my chronoscence to savor his stupidity for a moment. My foot slammed downward, propelling my form forward. Flashing my war scythe in a diagonal sweep, I bisected him, effortlessly cutting him from hip to shoulder. I sailed through the arterial spray of blood where his body once stood, his halved remains parted, slowly descending to the floor. 1. I stated to myself. I gave a hard flick of my blade and the lifeless Eldari were tossed to one side, leaving my weapon slick with their sanguine fluids. I felt the flashed storm of shuriken fire lance through my form, my living metal sealing the wound faster than they could do any significant damage. I directed my ire upon the guardian so foolish as to try my patience. A dozen of them fired upon me, as if concentrating fire would do anything to one as empowered as myself. Taking a low stance, I made my sweeping slash. The arc of my blade carved into four of their forces, cleaving them in half. Their rank broke and I clasped my hand around one retreating guardian's helm. And began to apply a gripping pressure, watching the Eldari squirm under the weight. The wraithbone cracked, snapping and breaking, also slowly due to my dragging perception of time. The guardian beat his gloved hands helplessly against my arms and death mask. He flailed for a moment longer before his head pulped crimson gore under my grip. 8. I tossed the corpse into the remaining guardians, sending several of them to the ground. Stabbing my scythe through the floor, I tore it through the black stone behind me as I ran onward. The fallen warriors were slashed through with little effort. I relished in their undignified demise. I continued to rend their ranks of insolent fodder, carefully weaving through the violent beams of disintegrating rays, and crossing lances of antimatter that mutilated these interlopers. I was making my way for another formation of guardians, when I was sent back flying. Warp lightning crackling off my mangled arm and warped torso. Already my system cycled hard to undo this damage, my perception of time returning to a regular flow. I let out a sound unbefitting of my station, and narrowed my oculars upon the damned souls who did this to me. A collection of heavily guarded warlocks. I counted them amongst the ones I had killed, as they were already dead in my eyes. 47, 48, 49, 50. I hefted myself up to my feet, calling to my fellow Praetorians to form up on me. Lobrina phalanx. They instantly fell in on my position, each rank in perfect unison. I raised the apotheosis orb from my side, the jade sphere crackling, its power waiting to be released. I activated the orb and a pulse of crackling lightning spread out from it. Renewed and empowered, we speared through the formation of guardians. Their shuriken fire unable to make a significant dent in our necrodermis shells. Their demicleaves shattering under our unyielding wrath. Their bodies breaking against our legion's perfect march. Warp fire cut us down by the dozens, but 10 dozen more immortals took their place. Burning gorse beams, transmuting in mythic slugs, atomizing lance beams, and the wicked razor edge of hundreds of hyperface blades. I severed the heads of 4 warlocks, and cut down dozens more of the verminous eldari, and still there were so many more in this fortress to claim. This slaughter would not end until the insides of every eldari painted the chamber walls of this star fort. Be the Annan and Ishska. Orokin and Phileas were quite receptive to the idea of deep strike and kamikaze in unison. We did lose around 67 night shrouds, which I don't know if we can really reconstruct the weaponry of them, but holy fuck, we killed a phantom titan. Watching the pilot ram the titan into the void stalker was beautiful, a hail of antimatter firing out, ending our connection. I was ready to head out, but Phileas pushed me back into the command throne. You'll remain here until after we have cleared the vermin of the fortress. Phileas leveled the outer edge of her scythe to my chest. Hushy didn't point the sharp towards me, that's a first. She left with her warriors and I noted that Trazin was actually gone. I was alone with the void crew for now. We would watch the bloody battle of Phileas and our shock troops. The Eldari were not rooted, but massacred. For every immortal they managed to kill, a dozen more ranks would leave the fleet ship to take their place. Scarabs began stealing their very atoms, their entropic presence a blight upon the Nifeers. Phileas running through row upon row of Guardian defenders and Cabalite lookalikes as if they were paper. Her face splattered in their gore and lifeblood. She was an unstoppable force on the battle door. I cheered for her and the legions of Necrons. I was overtaken by the bloodlust she inflicted to the Elder. But I feel quite quickly when she was nearly blasted in half by a gout horrendous warp beam. She was crumpled for a brief moment. No, get up, Phileas. I cried out as I saw her strewn there. I should have kept my mouth shut, as a moment as she rose promptly. And began a most brutal and horrific slaughter. Normally this amount of bloodshed would have stirred me, disturbed, even given me cause to loose my lunch. But instead there was the numbness and this murderous joy. They headed further into the fortress, butchering at least another 50 as they headed deeper. But our murderous intent was met with open arms. They came across a heavy force of 5 Wraith Lords and a collection of Black Guardians. They suffered some losses. Those that died would rematerialize back into the depths of Phileas' boarding ship. The Wraith Lords were not easily taken down as they had Bonacina spam to mend them. Phileas lost a good 15 of her Praetorian before they even managed to take down a single one of their well-armored Wraith Lords. It became a battle of attrition on our end. It wasn't a question if they were going to fall, but just a matter of when. The moment there was a compromise in their offensive line of Black Guardians, Phileas and her kin would make their strike. Their Eldari blades and fusion guns were a force to be reckoned with, as they were actually able to tear down half a dozen mobile platforms before we routed their number. When I saw that the battle was completed, nearly a third of the Triarch Praetorian had to be recuperated. Not to mention the losses we had from Immortals. They were reforged back in the Belefire Forges aboard Phileus' ship and returned to join back into the fray. I ordered along our own Canoptech constructs to flood the fortress in an attempt to map out the fortress. It dawned on me after I sent a quarter million constructs out that I had recently gained access to a few more forces. I deployed several of Chari's contraptions and drones from our fortress to accompany Phileus' forces. I was pleasantly surprised to find I could actually monitor their progress free of any interference, like when I watch through our own Necron units. The Guardian drones would actually be perfect to deploy. As to not just be constantly watching over Phileus' shoulder, I figured I could be doing more. I sent several ships to the several ruined and partly decimated remains of Eldari ships still floating in the void, that and the half-destroyed Void Stalker. We had the Blackstone Fortress draw in the ship's remains via our tractor beams, and we would have our scorpoid. That and the possibility of collecting any surviving Eldari that didn't somehow die in the detonations. I sent off several Deathmarks with their strange jetpacks to assist in this secondary task. I should probably check up on all these constructs who've made some of these advancements. Another time, I have work to do. I oversaw the collection of Eldari assets. I started to understand Trazin a bit better as I reclaimed several Eldari weapons from the shipwrecks. There were actually a fair few survivors in the Void Stalker. Navigational crew, each lightly armed and scattered throughout the ship. They had actually managed to set up several bombs across the ship, preparing for a desperate last stand. They managed to actually take out 79 individual Scorpoids and 23 Lichgood. It was actually frustrating. I wasn't upset with the Lichgood's death because they would be remade shortly. But the destruction of those individual constructs did really piss me off. We eventually did find a large collection of them held up in some supply chamber. A Gaket was about to pace them, but I stopped them. Instead, I called upon Nehebgor. He made quick work of freezing the entire chamber within a chronostatic field, a bubble of frozen time. These fuckers were gonna pay. And with the added fact I probably wasn't ever going to get a chance to interact with Eldari, this might be one of the best chances I have to mess with the Knife Ears. I summon up a few Minshical Scarabs. After the dirty deed was done, I had Nehebgor pocket the Eldari in a labyrinth. I stored the Tesseract in my own dimensional pocket and carried on. We've gotten our hands on several metric tons worth in D weapons, Neuro weapons, Prism weapons and Shrieker weapons. Most of these weapons were fucking terrifying. Hold on. Prism weapons and E weapons. Fuck. I needed to get into communications with Phileus. This shit in closed spaces will obliterate them. Regardless if they have Orokin, with armaments like these he might not even be able to jump back if Orokin gets destroyed with one of these. I'd have to figure out how to get in communication with them already a week deep in the fortress. Each combat encounter they have with these Eldari, they are losing a third or even half of their units. They haven't encountered any of the really heavy units. I headed back for the command bridge, charting a rapid path through the fortress that only took an entire day before I could return to the main chamber. As I entered the innermost chamber, I was about to message the Void crew to send a message, when my head started to cloud. Something was telling me I could get into contact more directly, instead of heading into the center spire that would lift me to the command chamber. I instead moved for one of the monolithic runes in the wall. I pressed my hand to the base of the rune. The wall hissed, letting out a pressurized hiss. Inside I found a chamber that previously I had overlooked in my first mind haze. But it was clear to me now. An active webway gate waiting to transport me where I needed to be. The Blackstone Fortress was going to transport me into its sister fortress. When I went through the open vortex, I found that the chamber I had ended up in was almost identical to the room I just entered. It was in a state of disrepair, rubble and collapsed slan statues littering the floor. If the construction of this fortress was the same as the other fortress, I should be able in the center of the fortress. While I could try and take control of the fortress, I could instead try and help out my own troops. It's inadvisable, but I actually wanted to see some elder dead by my own hand. Leaving the webway chamber, I entered a similarly vertigo-inducing chamber with a spire to the command chamber. I headed the opposite way, heading for the open doorway out into the outer rooms of the fortress. I could already hear a distant echo far ahead of me. I spent the next long while preparing the long antechamber, using the fortification cord to raise dozens of several walls and a throne. Dramatic entrances. I had Ildari to take care of soon. They were quickly approaching, heavily armed by the sounds of it. I was ready to meet them, ready to speak whatever party of Ildari came. There were around 150 of them. Frustratingly, for every 5 guardian defenders, they had a single heavy weapon platform armed with some of the bullshit weapons I had worried about. They also had quite a few illegally armed wraith lords. These bitches were breaking the rules. Guardian defenders get weapons platforms for every 10 units, not 5. And these wraith lord double bitches have a ghost glaive in each hand along with 2 shoulder mounted heavy weapons. Leading the spear tip formation was Farseer. She seemed to be visibly shaking. I was about to speak when she abruptly interjected. Cyclops. Oh hey, I know some Ildari. That's neat. I spent the next 3 seconds running through the engrams I had on Ildari accents, dialect, and phraseology. Straight for the slurs. So what can I do for you, knife ears? I quip with. Because you're about 17.4 million years too early to even try and claim one of these bad boys. She took a step back for a moment. She wasn't expecting me to know her crude alien tongue. She started on again. I have seen the flow of time, held sway over its headwaters, directed its many rivers and streams. But when I look upon your horrid mechanical visage, the streams of the future are stolen into eddies from which no stream can return. I chuckled. Starting off with prophetic babble, are we? You'd best use those prophecies for avoiding the fall rather than using it for the fortresses. She was perplexed, and took a step forward into the threshold of my constructions. What fall do you speak of, Cyclops? She asked. I answered. The fall of the Ildari, of course, but we're getting ahead of ourselves. So you have been divining my prescience. I had no plans to break our little armistice until I found you elves mucking up my fortress. Her troops tensed, slowly raising their cannons and shuriken weapons at me. The Farseer raised and leveled a sector to me. You cannot be allowed to live. Your visage has plagued my mind and my people's existence. To allow you to steal the talisman of all would be a folly unto folly. I let out a snickering sound. Hold on, you folks are just now realizing the talisman of all stories. Holy shit, I'm gonna bust a gasket. That's hilarious. I guess the Ildari really are better than the Elder. So you managed to find about these fortresses. And let me hear if I'm getting this right. Because we were using them against your kind in the future? She clenched her teeth. Precisely why you must die. She fired a gout of thundering warp lightning crackling my way. Before it even managed to cross a yard, I had already struck my fortification cord, the ground before me becoming uncertain and extending upwards. Like I wasn't going to have my chronoscence already dialed back for this entire conversation. The bout of electricity was met with a solid wall of black stone, and I casually stopped out from behind the wall. Hold the phone, knife ears. I wasn't done talking. I had to immediately step behind cover again as the Wraith Guard and the Wraith Lord opened fire on me. I refortified the wall several times before their 5-minute fire barrage died down. When I stepped down, my shoulder was nailed by a single shuriken projectile, which I dismissively plucked out and flicked to the side. The blackstone had a few holes in the surface, but nothing deep enough to have penetrated enough where it mattered. Most of the Ildari had crossed the threshold of the construction, which was a pleasant surprise for me. Holding her hand to stop her troops was the Farseer. You seem quite capable of molding this fortress to your own design, Tin Man. Oh, man, that was actually a good insult. I placed my hands on the top of my barricade and looked over the group. Flattery will get you nowhere, Farseer. Now where was I? Right, I wanted to ask you if that Void Stalker and all those little cruisers was all you had? I started to project my visions of the decimated fleet, the Titan getting destroyed and of course, a Blackstone Fortress destroying the cruiser fleet. I heard gasps, curses and even saw a few Guardian defenders take off their helms to hurl. You bastard. You murdered my fleet. The Farseer sent gout after gout of warp lightning and warp fire at me, which thanks to my chronoscence I was easily able to simply just duck out of the way. The Wraithblade started sprinting through the small maze Blackstone structures and so were her cannoned warriors. Struck a nerve, didn't I? I shouted over the hail of warp magics. I charged a sliver of power from the orb matrix at my back and hit the induction cord. The boom of sonic force ripped through the Blackstone construction, tossing the electrical energies free out. All this power near the heart of the fortress would make this a breeze. All this ambient energy was perfect for one thing. I struck the plasmancer's conduit cord and watched as the room lit up with thousands clusters of floating plasma and electrical orbs floating in the path of the Wraith Blades. A few tried to power through it, but when they found that the plasma orbs detonated upon impact, letting the superheated explosion tear them apart, the others took to caution. A few Wraith Blades actually started to climb onto the elevated platforms I had laid out. Oh no you don't. Right double quotation mark. I surged more power into my digit and struck the cord of entropy. A pair of Wraith Blades that were leaping towards my location were barely hit by the sonic boom of the cord's power. When one tried to land down on another elevated platform, its legs shattered like glass on the hard black stone before tumbling down to the ground. The other managed to close proximity to me, striking down its axe weapon upon me. But when it did so, his weapon and forearm cracked and shattered against my neck. I quickly ducked away after that. I heard detonations all around me, either they were shooting the airborne mines or they were still learning the hard way that the plasma was dangerous to living things. God, I can't wait till you're down to 2% of your population. I quickly ducked in between two elevated platforms. Sailing right over my head as my face met the Blackstone floor was a D-beam discharge that actually blew a chunk out of the fortification. I looked around to find a method to let me keep talking when I looked up and saw all the plasma orbs floating all around us. I quickly dedicated 26% of the power in my orb matrix and pointed my harp up west to a large collection of plasma orbs and electrical orbs, and violently strummed the cord of entropy. Immediately before I was to watch the chains of explosions that would go off, I shot my harp down and fired off another sonic boom of with the fortification, entombing myself under several yards of Blackstone. The series of explosions that overtook the antechamber shook me violently. It shattered through most of my fortification as I saw it crack above me. When I rolled out from cover, I found that I had killed quite around 29% of their forces. Absolutely decimated their melee boys. I yelled out. Are you ready to speak or should I keep killing your warriors? I heard a pained groan and yell, stand down. I peered out and found that two Wraith Lords and a Wraith Seer still remained in firing range but not in melee. Alright, now call off your Wraiths. I directed my harp at the Wraith Seer. The Farseer called them off, each of her big Wraiths stepping back, her weapons platforms still pointed at me. That's better, let's you and I talk knife ears. I'm Ishka, now this would be the part you give me your name. She spoke with all the haughty energy one would expect of a knife ears. I am of Vrala Ulthrabal, Council High Pharazer of the World Maya Resilien, and devotee to the goddess of fate Morihag. I balked. You're kidding me? Ulthrabal, you wouldn't happen to know someone with the name Ulthran or Ulthway? I asked. She frowned. I can't say that I do. She folded her arms. You've asked a question to allow me to return another to you. How is that you've managed to capture yourself a soul? I have foreseen a ghost within a shell of metal, and I believe you very much fit that description. I remained quiet for a moment. I internalized that question for a good while before I spoke again. Ask a different question. The one you have posed is not one I can answer you. She sneered. What is your intent with the Talisman of Vol? A weapon against the enemies of the galaxy. I am still quite undecided if your entire race counts as one. I answered truthfully. She ran a hand under her chin, contemplating my words. My turn. How far have you seen into the future? I need a number to see if our timelines match up. She paused and delivered more cryptic flowery bullshit. I have stared into the future seeing millennia ahead, yet you always remain a frustrating eddy in the waters of the future. I let out a sigh, processing her words. You mean to say you've seen what I can assume is only between 5 or 8 millennia, enough time for me to get a hold of most assets I need. And it seems I'm messing with your predictions of the future, am I getting this right? I heard some sort of Ildiri swear being flung my way, I think it came from the Wraith Seer. She didn't answer. I scooped up a dismembered arm, a Kainite warrior's left arm. The Kainites were a pleasant surprise, I suppose they do still exist in this time period. She finally spoke again. This entire time you've spoken as though you've had insights beyond this time. I will assume you two posses insights into the future. How far into the future is it that you can see, Diviner of the Necron? I let out a snicker, if Orican could see me now. I rested my face against the palm of the warrior's gloved palm. 17.6 million years roughly, and I got to say. The Ildiri's time will run its course near the end of that. Over 10,000 years of suffering under the thrusting maw of a warp god thing your people birthed. Can you believe that your people will really ruin the realm of souls for everyone? I immediately got lanced through the arm by one of the shuriken cannons from a wraith lord. The arm that was holding the severed Ildiri arm. I felt pain surge through my shoulder, my necrodermis doing its best to mend the pounding wound. Fuck, I've blown that arm off dozens of times and it always hurts like a bitch. The Farseer was seething as she watched me groan and shake in pain. I can see the irony in that, so I'll forgive that. I rose up, half expecting more shots, but none came. The Wraith Lord was made to stand in the back line with its infantry comrades. I picked up the arm and shoved it back in its socket, the living metal reconnecting wires, coolant tubes, and various systems back. No more of that please, until after I finish the lecture on how the Ildiri ruined the entire galaxy for everyone and stave off extinction with only 2% of their population. Okay. The Farseer begrudgingly let me go on. So let's see here, this may sound far-fetched, so I'll provide some projections to outline why your entire is slated to die. At the end I'll tell you how your race fell, and how to prevent it. That is of course if you accept a little deal I have in mind. If I wasn't always so impassive looking I'd be grinning ear to ear. At the height of your empire several million years from now, your race will birth forth a primordial annihilator god. A projection of Slaanesh was presented. I heard several guardian warriors stir, seeing a few avert their gaze. A chaos god, whose psychic birth scream will cull nearly every Ildiri in the galaxy. I showed a projection of the horrid warp god psychic shriek rippling across our galaxy. A scant few will survive, separated from their kin across stars. I showed several craft worlds separated all across the galaxy. The realm of souls shall open its eye in the material realm. I showed them the Eye of Terror and many Guardian Defenders turn tail. Something about what I showed them somehow was enough for them to run. I kept going. Your gods will be destroyed, Azurian, Vol, Kernus, G, Lilith and even your most precious Moray Heg will all be murdered and eaten. I showed Slaanesh and the other gods killing and feasting upon the Ildiri pantheon. Cain being shattered, Isha being fought over and fed horrid bile by Nurgle. Only 24 Guardian Defenders and 38 Black Guardians didn't break rank and fled, I was demoralizing them. What small remnants of your people remain will be divided, broken into other subraces, the Craft World Elder, the Drukhari, the Exodites, the Harlequins. I showed them each of their kind, though I may have shown them in excess the lengths of depravity and mutilation the Dark Elder fell to. Just a healthy presentations of the brutal delights of their murder sports, homunculus creations, the horrid floating engines of pain's wailing. These elder, your distant descendants will struggle to remain alive, futile fight after futile fight. I showed constant elder losses, death at the hands of overwhelming Slaanesh forces, entire craft worlds being bombarded by Fulgrim, the entire travesty of Iandon's constant destruction. When I paused for dramatic flair I saw that the Farseer was almost manic looking. Her hair stood on end, her eyes almost bulging, tears streaming down her cheeks, and warp lightning crackling off of her. Why don't you calm, mull over that information for a week or two, I'm quite patient. That and I would prefer to not to kill you or be killed myself. She let a pain howl, reality becoming undone around her. Ripples in the material realm crackled and surged in violent electrical vortexes above the Farseer. My head pounded. I could feel something leak from my nose. Not blood, coolant. I took cover so as to not stare at the reality fissure her distress was causing. I saw warp fire roil across the room from my small holdout. She was hitting with a crushing psychic maelstrom. I could feel static taking over my vision. I needed to do something before this psychic assault destroyed my soul. I lifted myself to look upon her, my clumsy digits trying to fire a hit from one of my cords. I surged 45% power from the orb into my fingers before I yanked a random cord. My fingers were sluggish, but what I saw was clear. A great focused beam of warp lightning broke free from my harp, bucking me off to the side. The cord of positively disintegrated along with most of my forearm. The beam had lanced into the Farseer's arm and reduced one of her arms into an explosion of gore. The carnage continued as the beam moved east into a line of black guardians. Some were reduced to ash, others threw up weak psychic barriers that easily popped. Their blood and gore splattered the floor before the beam lit up. I needed to survive. You assaulted me. I yelled out as the remaining opened fire on me. My chronoscence was sputtered as I tried to minimize damage to my person. Sharply turning on my heel, my cape of tiles was partially obliterated by a prism cannon, tiles flying free clattering all across the floor. I blocked a shuriken cannon shot with my ruined forearm, mostly surprised that the simp eternal weave had actually survived even if it was functionally just a stump of an arm. Look at what you made me do. I cried out as I ducked behind a wall. I was getting a heavy stream of fire on me, and my cover would likely break soon. I peeked around the corner. The Wraithseer was carrying off the Farseer deeper into the fortress. I was going to follow, but another fucking D-cannon shot broke part of my cover. The warp fire wasn't letting up, and I was down to 18% power on my matrix orb, and the wounds I had sustained was slowly healing. I needed to make it to my command throne. Making a break for it, I ducked and wove, but I wasn't fucking speedy at all. A few seconds after I left cover, both of my legs were sheared off in a single swing by one Wraithlord's glaive. I tumbled end over end only a few feet from my command throne. Pain racked my form. Fuck Auric and won't be here for weeks, and who knows how many times he might have jumped after I die. I could swear the warp fire around me laughing. I could feel something in my chest beating. I gripped my tail input as I groveled closer to the throne. The Wraithlord flipped me over right as I was at the foot of my command throne. The titanic Wraith Construct's voice was bone-chilling. Consider this justice for the warriors you've slaughtered. The Wraithlord raised his glaive back, giving me just enough time. I slammed my input into a slot in the command throne. Power surged into me. Before the battle, I had prepared myself for this lovely piece of insurance. I had hooked myself to the Blackstone Fortress's power grid, and I was feeling an overwhelming amount of power flow into me. My chronoscence had entirely stopped time at this moment. I had the time to think a way out of this. Why not try something classic? I turned the harp upon myself. My orb matrix was already fully charged, and I had a Blackstone Fortress worth of energy just waiting for me to draw from it. I placed my fingers on the waveform and the iconoclast cord, tugging them. The transmuting cone washed over form with greater force. I could see the glaive spearing downwards, its blade threading the space between threads of my harp. But it was beyond too late for the Wraith Lord. My necrodermis shimmered with the light of stars, my shell transmuted once more to that of the Cetan phase form. The blade struck the casket-shaped tank at the center of my chest, its blade simply fasting through my chest harmlessly. My arm stretched out with taloned digits. I pulled myself through the glaive, raising myself above the height of the immense construct. I took its head, taking a page from Phileas Page. Rather than simply crushing the Wraith thing, I transmuted the psychoplastic substance into dust, its spirit stone reduced to atoms and grains between my digits. I looked to the remaining guardians, Bonasingers, three warlocks and Wraith Lords. I waved my hand, transmuting the guardians and Bonasingers into calcium statues. Facing the remaining Wraith Lords and the I saw that they were trying to fire off their weapons upon me. I tossed a lancing beam of electricity into the wraith construct, its wraith bone crackling, fracturing before exploding out into a hail of shards. My attention drifted off to the warlocks. Their empiric powers couldn't be tolerated. 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 I cycled my systems and began increasing my, their empiric powers couldn't be tolerated, radiation output. Their empiric powers couldn't be tolerated. Their empiric powers couldn't be tolerated. Their empiric powers couldn't be tolerated. They writhed in agony. Cants, their empiric powers couldn't be tolerated. House growths sprouted over them as their bodies were poisoned. Their empiric powers couldn't be tolerated. Their empiric powers couldn't be tolerated. Their empiric powers couldn't be tolerated. With the threat eliminated, I flew around the room to try and locate. The tether that connected me to my command throne seemed to extend as my body flew free. When I looked for the Wraith Seer and Farseer, they were nowhere to be found. The fortress spire had not been accessed. I turned to the open webway chamber and found it powering down, having just been used. My rage boiled over, my consciousness streaming into every facet of the fortress. There was one line of logic my mind followed and began to impose on every inch of the fortress. Their empiric powers couldn't be tolerated. My order was carried out as waves of billfire spread out from around me. It extended out in every direction, charging every atom of the fortress to a negative polarity. A week later, when the burning billfire form of Phileas arrived, I had already dominated the entire fortress. Well guys, hope you enjoy today's video. We are going to assume you have if you have stayed to the end. Consider subscribing and clicking the notification bell if you really enjoyed it to stay up to speed with any and all new videos. Also check out the links below to our shop for some fat ass titties and our sponsor Rural, and be sure to use a promo code at checkout so they know we sent you and you'll get 10% off. And until next time.